Acacia, Book 1, The War with the Mean, by David Anthony Durham. Narrated by Dick Hill. Copyright 2007 by David Anthony Durham. This audiobook is published by arrangement with David Anthony Durham and International Creative Management, and was produced in the year 2007 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright there too. Book 1, The King's Idol. Chapter 1. The assassin left the stronghold of Mean Tahalian by the great front gate, riding through a crack in the armored pine beams just wide enough to let him slip out. He departed at sunrise, dressed much as any soldier of the Mean. He wore a cloak of elk fur that wrapped his body completely. It even covered his legs and gave warmth to the large hoofed mount beneath him. Over his torso, he wore a breastplate of double thickness, two sheaves of iron pounded to the contours of his body with a layer of otter fur pressed beneath them. He moved south through a snowy land frozen into gelid brilliance. The winter was so bitterly cold that for the first few days the man's breath crystallized as it escaped his lips. The vapor formed a strange protuberance around his mouth, making the passage into it a cave-like channel. Knots of ice dangled from his beard, brushing against each other like glass chimes. He met few people, even when he passed through settlements of low-domed shelters. He saw the prints of white foxes and hares in the snow, but rarely the creatures themselves. Once a snow cat paused to watch his progress from atop a boulder, its gaze one of indecision, considering whether he ought to flee the rider or pursue him. In the end he did neither, and the man put the beast to his back. On one occasion he crested a rise and looked out upon a plain teeming with reindeer. It was a sight almost unseen since distant times. At first he thought he might have wandered upon a gathering from the spirit world. Then he smelled the musty stink of the animals. This broke the mood of mystery. He rode down into them, taking joy in the way the herd peeled away from him, the sound of their hooves a rumble he felt inside his chest. If Mean lands had been their own, he might have hunted these creatures as his ancestors had. But his wish did not change the reality. The race of people called the Mean, the high northern plateau of the same name, the great fortress of Tahalian, the royal line of men who should rule the territory without interference, all had been servants to Acacia for the last 500 years. They had been defeated, massacred in great numbers, and since overseen by foreign governors. They had been taxed unfairly and robbed of fighting men, many of whom were sent to serve in the Acacian military in distant lands far from home, out of the hearing of their ancestors. This, at least, was how the rider saw it, as an injustice that should not go on forever. Twice in the first week he cut away from the main road to avoid Northern Guard checkpoints. His papers were in order. In all likelihood he would not have been delayed, but he had no trust in Acacians and abhorred the notion of even feigning acknowledgment of their authority. Each looping excursion brought him closer to the black mountains that paralleled his route. Their peaks jutted up out of the snow like enormous flakes of obsidian that had been chipped to razor sharpness. If old tales were to be believed, the summits were the points of spearheads slammed up through the roof of their world by the race of angry giants whose own land lay beneath the earth's skin. After 10 days of riding, he reached the edge of the Mathalian rim, the southern boundary of the Mean. He paused a moment to look down at the fertile woodlands 3,000 feet below, aware that he would never again breathe the high country air. He slipped the headgear from his mount and dropped it where he stood. He chose a looser rein arrangement that bore no trace of his origins. Though it was still chilly and the land dusted with frost, he unfastened his cloak and tossed it to the ground. He drew out a dagger and slit the leather band that secured his helmet. He hurled the dome into the bushes and shook out his hair. Loosed from the confines of pounded metal, it whipped out, as if in joy at the newfound freedom, long and brown. His hair was one of the features that had prompted him to take this assignment on. It bore little resemblance to the brittle straw coloration of most of the mean race, and had always embarrassed him. After putting on a cotton shirt to disguise his breastplate, the horseman and his mount descended from the heights. They rode a switchback trail that spilled out onto a terrain of an altogether different sort, a temperate forest of hardwood trees, dotted with the small woodland settlements that made up the northern extent of the lands administered directly from Alicia, the bureaucratic seat of the Acacian government. As his mastery of the Empire's tongue was loathsome to him, he rarely spoke to anybody, except on the occasions that he had no choice. When he sold his horse to a trader at the southern edge of the woodlands, he growled into the back of his hand, mumbling and gruff. He accepted in payment coins of the realm, clothes that would not attract attention, and a sturdy pair of leather boots as he would walk the rest of the way to the shore. Thus he was transformed again. He followed the main road to the south, a large sack slung over his shoulder. It bulged here and there with the items he would yet need. He passed the nights huddled in depressions at the edge of farms or in patches of woodland. Though the people around him believed the land to be gripped by winter, to him it was more like a Tahalian summer, warm enough that he found himself sweating. Not far from the port of Alicia, he discarded his garb once more. He peeled off his breastplate, sunk it beneath stones in a river bed, and took up a cloak that had been sewn in the cold chambers of the mean, hoping that it would pass for authentic. With it draped across his shoulders, he appeared to be one of the Vedaean. Though an ancient order, the Vedaean were no longer the functioning religious sect they had once been. They were scholars who studied and preserved the old lore under the ceremonial direction of the priestess of Veda. They were a close-mouthed group, disdainful of the workings of the empire. As such, it would not appear odd that he had few words for those around him. To complete his appearance, the man shaved the sides of his head and bound the long hair at the top of his skull up into one tight knot, wrapped in thin strips of leather. The skin at either side of his head was as pale and pink as pig flesh. He rubbed a tanning agent used to stain wood into it. Once completed, none but the keenest of eyes would have taken him for anything other than the scholar he pretended to be. Though he wore these various guises with composure, he was, in truth, none of the things he passed for. His name was Thasrin Mean. He was born of noble blood, son of the late Heberin Mean. He was the younger brother of Hanish, the rightful chieftain of the tribes of the Mean Plateau, and of Mayander, head of the Punasari, the elite guard force and proud heart of his people's martial tradition. It was a lineage to be proud of, but he had set all else aside to become an assassin. For the first time, his existence truly made sense to him. He had never been more focused than he was now, more complete in himself, charged with a mission he had sworn his life to. How many, walking the earth, know exactly why they breathe, and understand exactly what they must do before passing into the afterdeath? How fortunate he was. From aboard a transport boat, he watched the Isle of Acacia push out of the pale green sea in a knotted jumble of rock. It was innocent enough at a distance. The island's highest point was at the southern end. In the center, the hilly farmland and ridges dropped somewhat, but rose again into the series of plateaus that generations of settlement had carved into a land fit to house the palace. Acacia trees stood as dark as the black-skinned Talayans of the south, wearing great crests of plumage, dotted here and there with white blossoms. Despite the great twisting length of the island's coastline, relatively little of it was easily accessible. Beaches and ports were few. Sailing past the port's protective towers, Thasserin saw a flag of the Empire, hanging limp from lack of breeze. He knew from the colors what he would see if it had stood out. A yellow sun inside a red-bordered square, at the center a black silhouette of the tree that gave this island its name. Every child of the known world recognized the emblem, no matter how far distant their place of birth. The assassin had to check his desire to clear the phlegm from his throat and spit in contempt. He climbed from the boat to the main dock in a rush of other passengers, merchants and laborers, women and children, all leaping the gap above the crystal-clear water like herd animals. There were a few other Vidaean among them, but Thasserin avoided eye contact with them. Standing on the solid stone of the dock as his fellow passengers moved around him, he understood that he was about to step into the mouth of the enemy. If any person around him now found out his name, or could divine his thoughts, he would become the target of every dagger, sword, and spear on the island. He waited a moment longer than he intended, surprised that nobody condemned him. Nobody shouted warnings, or even paused to study him. He took in the great wall of a pinkish stone with cold eyes. Beyond it, spires and towers and domes jutted up into the air, many of these painted dark blue or a somber red or a brown with a rusty quality, some gilded and twinkling in the sunlight. The structures rose terraced level by level with the steepness of a sheer mountain. It was beautiful to behold. Even he could acknowledge that much. It was nothing like the low, brooding presence of the assassin's home. Tehalion was built with massive beams of fir wood, half dug into the ground as protection from the cold, undecorated because so much of the year it was drowned in winter darkness, with snow piled high on every flat surface. The difference between the two was hard to square, and so Thasserin shook off thought of it. He strolled toward the gates of the lower town. It might take some time, but he would find his way deep into the city, taking on whatever guises he needed until he gained entry to the palace itself. There, he would answer the question put casually by his second brother just a month before. If they wished to kill a beast with many arms, Meander had said, why not cut off the head to start with? Then they could deal with the limbs and body as the creature stumbled around, sightless, without leadership. The assassin had only to get near enough to this head, and to wait for the proper moment to strike it, and to do it in public so that word of the act would spread like a contagion from one mouth to another. Chapter 2. To help her through the slow tedium of the morning tutorial, Mina Akaran always sat in exactly the same spot, on a tuft of grass behind her siblings. She had just turned 12, and from this vantage point she could see through a missing tooth in the stone balustrade that hemmed in the courtyard. It framed a scene that began with the many-layered terraces of the palace. It dropped through a stretch of space beyond the town's western wall, then gave way to the swelling ranks of the cultivated hills. The farthest rise of land was the highest, the far promontory known as Haven's Rock. She had been there with her father and remembered the foul-smelling, cacophonous seabird life of the place, with head-dizzying views that dropped a craggy 1,500 feet straight into the foaming swells. Sitting in the high, open-air classroom in which the king's children met with their tutor, Mina's thoughts would drift off. This morning, she imagined herself a gull, pushing free of the rock face. She hurtled down and shot out over the surface of the water. She darted between the sails of fishermen's vessels and out over the trading barges that floated the sea on the circular currents that moved them from one place to another. She left these behind, and the waves grew steeper. The turquoise water deepened to blue, and then to seal black. She flew past the shoals of sparkling anchovies and out over the backs of whales, seeking the unknown things that she knew would eventually emerge from the white-capped edge of the horizon.
Mina, are you with us, princess?
Jason, the royal tutor, and both her brothers and her sister were all staring at her. The children sat on the damp grass. Jason stood before them, poised with an old volume in one hand, his other one resting on his hip.
Did you hear the question?
Of course she did not hear the question,
Alivar said. At 16, he was the eldest of the king's children, the heir apparent to the throne. He had recently shot upward past his father's height, and his voice had changed. His expression was one of interminable boredom, an illness that struck him about a year ago and had yet to release him.
She was thinking about fish again, or about porpoises. Neither fish nor porpoises have bearing on the topic we're discussing,
Jason said.
So I'll repeat. Whom did the founder of the Akaran dynasty unseat at Galaral?
That was the question she missed.
Anybody could answer that. Mina hated responding to simple questions. She found pleasure in knowledge only when she stood out from others. Dariel, her younger brother, knew who the first king was and what he had done, and he was only 9. She held out for as long as she could, but when Alivar opened his mouth with some jibe, she spoke quickly.
Oedipus was the founder. He was born into suffering and darkness in the lakes, but he prevailed in a bloody war that engulfed the whole world. He met the untrue King Tartha at Galaral and crushed his forces with the aid of Santoth speakers. Oedipus was the first in an unbroken line of 21 Akaran kings, of which my father is the most recent. Oedipus's sons, Thaleran, Tinhardin and Prathos set about securing and solidifying the empire through a series of campaigns called the Wars of Distribution.
All right, Jason said.
More than I asked for. A seagull.
What?
I was being a seagull, not a fish or a porpoise.
She scrunched up her face at Alivar and then turned to give Corinne the same. Sometime later, after having tried unsuccessfully to resume her avian imaginings, Mina contented herself with following the conversation. The discussion had turned to geography. Corinne named the 6 provinces and managed to say something about their ruling families and forms of government. The mainland to the near north, the satrapy of the Mean in the far north, the Candovian Confederacy to the northwest, Tele to their south, and the mountain tribes of Senebal to the west. The linked islands, collectively called the Bumu Archipelago, made up the last province, though it did not have the centralized government of the others. Jason rolled a map out on the grass and had the children tack the edges down with their knees. Dariel always took particular pleasure in maps. He leaned close to it and repeated anything the tutor said as if he were translating the information for another listener. Something about the slow way he did this spurred Mina to interrupt him.
"Why is Acacia always at the center of maps?"
she asked.
"If the world curves and has no end, as you taught us, Jason, how is one place the center and not another?"
Corinne found the question silly. She glanced at Jason with upraised eyebrows and a wrinkled pursing of her lips.
At 15, she was attractive,
and knew it, with the olive complexion and rounded face that had come to epitomize Acacian beauty. Much of their dead mother, Alira, lived on in her, at least That was what everyone seemed to think.
It just is the center, Mina. Everyone knows that.
Succinctly put, Jason said. But Mina does make a point. All peoples think of themselves first. First, central and foremost, yes? I should show you a map from Tele sometime. They draw the world quite differently. And why wouldn't they think themselves the center of the world? They are a great nation also.
Oliver guffawed.
Be serious. The men and women walk around half naked down there. They hunt with spears and worship gods that look like animals. They still use small tribal governments, chiefs and all that. They are no better than the squabbling mean.
And it's too hot there, Corinne added. They say the earth dries to powder for half the year. They have to drink from holes dug in the ground.
Jason conceded that the Talayan climate was harsh, especially in the far south, and he knew they would always think of their ways as inferior to Acacian customs. There was a reason Acacia held sway over the entire known world. He said,
"We are a gifted people, but we are also a benevolent people. We should not disdain Talayans or any other—"
"I didn't say I disdain them. They have their ways, and when I am king, I will try to respect them. Now, why is this map out? Do you have something to teach us or not?"
Jason, noting the flare of impatience in Oliver's tone, nodded. He smiled his agreement and let the topic drop. He was a teacher, yes, but he never forgot that he was also a servant. Sometimes that seemed unfortunate to Mina. How were they to truly learn about the world if they could silence their tutors just by raising the pitch of their voices? The lesson resumed, all of them listening to Jason without further interruption. But they were not at it long. A few minutes later, their father, King Leodan, pushed through the doorway and breathed in the morning air. His face had the texture of tanned leather. A dusting of white hair spread around his temples, highlighting his otherwise dark hair, betraying both his age and his kingly burdens. He took in his children, nodded at the tutor, and then looked out across the panoramic view of his island. He said,
"Jason, I am going to interrupt your teaching this morning. With the delegation from Orshenia arriving shortly, I will not have all the time I would like for my children in the coming weeks. I awoke with a desire to run the horses. I'm inclined to indulge it. If my children wish to accompany me, the matter would be decided."
The children were so inclined, and within the hour they galloped out through one of the small side gates of the palace. All the children had ridden since their fourth or fifth year, and all were more than competent, even Dariel. A guard of 10 horsemen followed them at a discreet distance. Nobody could imagine the king to be at risk while on Acacia, but as a monarch he was quite often made to bend to traditions from more perilous times. They rode briskly out along the high road to the west. The narrow track at times traversed such thin ridges that one could look at a vista on either side that dropped down juniper-covered slopes, careening all the way to the sea. The thorny crowns of acacia trees occasionally broke through the thin-webbed canopy. It was these, of course, that gave the island its name and the Akaran dynasty its informal title. They were a distinguishing feature of the landscape, unique among the other islands of the inner sea, none of which had acacias. Up close, the trees had frightened Mina when she was younger. They were gnarled and thorny, so still and yet always having about them the threat of latent life, an intelligence within, that she suspected they chose to keep hidden for their own reasons. She had grown comfortable near them only lately. An aged, sanded, and tamed specimen had been transplanted to Dariel's room as a frame to climb about on, a plaything. This had done much to ease her apprehensions. They could be cut and moved and shaped into toys for children. Hardly things to fear. The riders dropped down to the rugged beach of the southern coastline, a stretch of shore left in its natural state, with views across the bay at cliffs thriving with bird life. For a while they rode in a loose group, around and between great limbs of sun-bleached driftwood, or out into the glass-green water, the horses kicking through the froth. Dismounted, Oliver tossed seashells out at the waves. Corinne stood on the decaying trunk of an enormous tree, her arms out to either side and her face pointed into the chilly breeze. Daryl chased fiddler crabs across the sand. Mina chose to stand at her father's right hand as he walked from one to the other of them, interested in all, laughing, for so many things seemed to amuse him when he was with his children. She held a twig of driftwood in her fingers, running her fingertips over the weathered grain of it. This was exactly the way life was supposed to be. She did not question whether such a thing, a king cavorting with his children, was unusual. It was simply the way it always had been. She could imagine no other possibility. She did wonder, though, if anyone but her saw the strain behind their father's facade. His joy was sincere, but it was not without effort. It was painful in some measure because of the one who was absent. That evening, back once more in the warm hive of the palace, Mina and Dariel curled up on her bed to hear their father tell a story. Like all rooms in the palace, Mina's was large, wide, and tall, with floors of polished white marble. It was not a room on which Mina had exerted any of her own influence, unlike Corinne in her lacy, brightly colored, and variously cushioned nest. The furniture was uniformly ancient, pieces made of gnarled hardwood, with upholstery that tickled the skin. Tapestries depicting figures from Acacian history hung on the walls. She could name the deeds of only a few of them, but she felt their presence in the room as a protective force. They were watching over her. They were, after all, her father's people, her own. Leodan sat on a stool beside them.
"So," he said, "I think we have reached the point where I must tell you the story of the two brothers and how the great friction began between them. It's a shame that Corinne and Oliver are too old for stories. They once liked this one, even though it's sad."
The king explained that there was once a time in the far past when the two brothers, Bashar and Cashin, were so close they could not be separated. A knife blade could not be slipped between them, such was their love for each other and joy at being in each other's company. At least, this was true until the day that a delegation from a nearby village came to them and said that since the two of them were such good and noble brothers, they prayed that one of them would become something called a king. They had been told by a dreamer prophet that if they had a king, they would find prosperity. This they sorely needed, for they had suffered famine and discord for years. None of them could decide who among them should be king, so they implored one of the brothers to step into the role. The two brothers asked if they could both be kings, but the villagers said that was not possible. Only one man can be the king of a place, they said. That was what the prophet had told them. But still the brothers liked the idea of being royal. They said that the villagers could choose between them, and that the unchosen one would abide by the decision. In secret, they made a pact that after 100 years they would switch roles, and he who had not been king would then become it. Cashin was chosen and made king. For 100 years he ruled without incident. The people thrived. Bashar was always at his side. But on the first day of the 101st year, Bashar asked that Cashin hand over the crown. Cashin looked at him coldly.
He had grown used to being king, fond of the power he wielded. Bashar reminded him of their agreement, but Cassian claimed that no such words had ever passed between them. Hearing this, Bashar was filled with anger. He grappled with his brother. Cassian threw him off, and, feeling a sudden fear and shame, ran from the village up into the hills. He drained himself of all loving thought for his brother and filled himself with bitterness instead. Bashar chased him through the hills and into the mountains. Storm clouds gathered and bolts of lightning illumined the sky and rain poured down on them.
Dariel tapped his father on the wrist with a finger. Is this true?
Leaning toward him, Leodan whispered, Every word of it.
They sure have taken turns,
Dariel said, his voice edged with fatigue.
When Bashar reached his brother, he cracked him over the head with his staff. Cassian went weak-kneed for a moment, but then he shook off the blow and came at Bashar again. This time Bashar swung his staff around and caught his brother at the knees, spilling him onto his back. He tossed his staff away and grabbed his brother, hefted him up, and walked with him above his head toward the precipice. The wind battered and howled at him, but still he managed to reach the edge, where he tossed his brother over into the void.
But Cassian did not perish. He bounced and rolled and tumbled down the slope. He regained his footing and began to run. He bounded across the valley floor and came up on the other side. As he rose to the crest of the far mountain, a lightning bolt ripped through the sky. The light was blinding, and Bashar had to cover his eyes against it. When he could see again, Bashar realized that Cassian had been struck. But instead of dropping to the ground dead, his body quivered and tingled with energy. Blue light fanned out across his skin and over his charred flesh. He did not perish, though. He began to run once more, and now he was swifter than before. He took enormous steps and climbed to the peak of the far mountain and jumped over it without so much as a backward glance at his brother. Mina let the silence after this linger for a moment, then asked,
Is that the end?
Leodan shushed her and nodded toward Dariel, indicating that he had fallen asleep.
No,
he said, beginning to slide his arms under the boy. That is not all, but it's the end of this night's story. Bashar realized that some god had reached down and blessed his brother. He knew then that they were to be foes in a long and difficult battle. Truth be known, they still are fighting. Leodan pushed himself upright. Dariel draped over his arms in the dead weight of slumber.
Sometimes, if you listen carefully, you can hear them throwing stones at each other in the mountains.
Watching her father's back as he passed through the open portal, turned toward the glare of yellow light from the hall lamp and stepped out of view, Mina fought back the sudden urge to call out. It came to her like a gasp for air, as if she had been holding her breath unwittingly. It was the sudden, dreadful certainty that her father would vanish into that corridor, never to be seen again. When she was younger, she often called him back, time and again, for comfort, stories, and promises, until his patience wore thin, or until she dropped, senseless from fatigue. But lately she had grown embarrassed by whatever emotion choked her at parting from him. It was her burden to bear, and bear it she did. She realized that she had clenched her bedsheets tight in her two fists. She tried to loosen her fingers and spread calm up from them and through the rest of her. It was fear without substance, she told herself. Leodan had told her as much many times. He would never leave her. He promised it with complete, undeniable parental certainty. Why could she not just believe him? And why did the wish that she believed him feel like a slight to her dead mother? She knew that many children her age had never suffered the loss of a parent. Even sleeping Daryl could not remember their mother enough to miss her. He knew nothing of what had been lost. Ah, such a kind thing, that ignorance. If only she had been born the youngest instead of Daryl. She was not sure if this was a mean thought, unkind to her brother, but she was a long time thinking about it. Chapter 3. Thaddeus Clegg could see from the moment he entered his chamber that the woman was about to collapse from exhaustion. She stood in the center of the torchlit room, facing the far wall, cast in silhouette by the orange glow from the fireplace. She swayed from side to side with the awkward, off-kilter movements of the truly fatigued. Her garments were as soiled and bedraggled as a peasant's, but beneath the caked dirt and grime, Thaddeus could make out the glint of her chainmail vest. The tight-fitting skullcap of her helmet was distinctive enough with its single tuft of yellow horsehair at the peak.
"Messenger," Thaddeus said, "my apologies that you had to wait for me standing. My servants hold to formality, even in the face of reason."
The woman's eyes flashed up.
"Why have I been kept here, Chancellor? My message is for King Leodan, by orders of General Lika Alain of the Northern Guard."
Thaddeus turned to his servant, who had shadowed him as he entered the room, and instructed him to bring the messenger a plate of food. As the servant shuffled out of the room, Thaddeus motioned for the woman to sit on one of the couches just behind him. It took some convincing, but when he lowered himself, the messenger followed his example. He explained that she was there before him precisely because her message was for the king. As chancellor, he received all communications first.
"Certainly you know this," he said,
the slightest suggestion of reprimand in the purse of his lips. At 56 years of age, Thaddeus had left behind the handsome appearance of his youth. The invariable sun of Acacian summers had carved deep creases in his skin, lines that seemed to sprout anew each time he gazed at himself in a hand mirror. Still, sitting upright within the reach of the wavering firelight, with his arms folded in his lap and the dark red satin of his winter cloak around him, the Chancellor looked every bit at home in his station as confidant to the ruler of the largest empire in the known world. He had been born just months after Leodan Akaran, to a family nearly as royal, but he had been told early that his role was to serve the future king, not aspire to such heights himself. He was a constant confidant, the first ear for any secret, the eyes that saw the monarch as only those of his immediate family were allowed. He had been assigned his role and status at birth, as had been the case with each of the 22 generations of chancellors before him. The servant returned, bearing a tray spread with plates of smoked oysters and anchovies, grapes and two carafes, one of lime water and one of wine. Thaddeus motioned that the woman should help herself.
"Let there be no discord between us," he said. "I can see that you are an earnest soldier, and from the look of your clothes you have had a harsh journey. The mean must be an icy misery this time of the year. Drink. Take a breath. Remember that you are within the walls of Acacia, and then tell me what you have to."
"General Alain sent—"
"Yes, you said that Lika sent you. You were not sent by the governor."
"This message comes from General Alain," the messenger said. "He sends his most devoted praise and affection to the king and to his four children. May they live long. He swears his loyalty now as ever, and he asks that the king listen to his words with care. They are all true. even if his message will seem incredible.
Thaddeus glanced at his servant. After he left the room, the Chancellor said,
"The king listens through me."
Hanish Mean is planning a war against Acacia.
Thaddeus smiled.
Not likely. The Means are not fools. Their numbers are small. The Acacian Empire would crush them like ants underfoot. When did Lika become such a...
Sir, forgive me, but I have not finished my report.
The messenger seemed saddened by this fact. For a moment she rubbed at the bags beneath her eyes.
It is not just the Mean we must contend with. Hanish Mean has struck some alliance with people from beyond the ice fields. They have come over the roof of the world and south into the Mean.
The Chancellor's smile faded.
That is not possible.
Sir, I swear by my right arm that they come south by the thousands. We believe they do so at the call of Hanish Mean.
He has gone out of the known world.
Scouts have seen them coming. They are a strange people, barbaric and fierce.
Foreign people are always thought to be barbaric and fierce.
They are taller than normal men by more than a head. They ride atop woolly creatures, horned things that trample men underfoot. They come not just with soldiers, but with women and children and the elderly, with great carts like moving cities, pulled by rows of hundreds and hundreds of beasts like none I have heard described before. It is said they wield siege towers and other strange weapons with them, and manage great herds of livestock.
You describe wandering nomads. These are figments of some liar's fancy.
If these be nomads, they are like none our world has ever seen. They sacked a town called Vedus in the far north. I say sacked, but in truth, they simply rolled over it. They left nothing behind, but grasped up everything of value and carried it with them.
How do you know Hanish Mean has anything to do with this?
The messenger fixed the Chancellor in her gaze. She could have been no older than 25, but there was more than that length of suffering and perseverance in her face. Thaddeus had often believed this to be true of female soldiers. They were, by and large, cast of finer steel than average men. She knew what she was talking about, and he should acknowledge it. Thaddeus rose and motioned the woman toward a large chart of the Empire on the far wall.
Show me these things on the map. Tell me all you can.
For the next hour, the two talked, one asking questions with ever-increasing gravity, the other answering with conviction. Running his eyes over the chart, Thaddeus could not help but imagine the howling wildness of the place they discussed. No other region of the known world was as troublesome as the Mean satrapy. It was a harsh northern plateau region, a land of 9-month winters, and of a blonde-haired race of people who managed to survive there. The plateau bore the name of the people who inhabited it, but the Mean were not native to the region. They had once been a mainland clan from the eastern foothills of the Cenovalian Mountains, not all that different from the early Acacians. After an earlier displacement, at the hands of the old Akarans, they had settled there and been forced to call it their home for 22 generations, just as the Akarans had made Acacia their base for the same amount of time. The Mean were a tribal, warlike, bickering people, as harsh and prone to callousness as the landscape they inhabited, with a culture built around a spiteful pantheon of spirits called the Tunish Nevra. They held in common a pride in their shared ancestry, which they protected by living a cloistered existence. They married only with each other and condemned interbreeding with other races. Because of their perceived racial purity, any Meanish male could claim the throne as his own, so long as he won it through the death duel called the Maseret.
This system made for a rapid turnover of rule, with each new chieftain having to win the approbation of the masses. Once crowned, the new chieftain took the race's name as his own, signifying his representation of all his people. Thus, their current leader, Hanish of the line Heberon, became Hanish Mean on the day he fought his first Majoret and retained the crown of his deceased father. The fact that Hanish roiled with hatred for Acacia was not news, certainly not to the Chancellor. But what this soldier was telling him outstripped his imaginings. At Thaddeus's urging, the messenger consumed all the food on the plate. Another was brought, with cheese this time, the hard variety that had to be cut with a sharp knife. The Chancellor sliced wedges for both of them, and then drew back with the blade in hand. He stared at his reflection in it as he listened. The messenger tried to fight away sleep, but as the night turned into the silent hours, her eyelids drooped.
"I fear I am failing," she finally said. "But I have explained everything to you. May I now have an audience with the king? These things are meant for his ears."
At the mention of the king, Thaddeus had an unexpected thought, not at all what he would have anticipated at this moment. He recalled the day the previous summer when he had found Leodan in the labyrinthine gardens of the palace. The king sat on a stone bench in an alcove, hemmed in on both sides by the vine-draped ancient stone that had been the foundation of the first king's more modest abode. His youngest son, Dariel, sat on his lap. Together they studied a small object held in the boy's hand. As Thaddeus approached, the king looked up with wondrous, joy-filled eyes and said,
"Thaddeus, come look!
We have discovered an insect with spotted wings." He said it like it was the most important thing in the world, as if he were a child just as much as his son. Thaddeus liked the king most during these clear-eyed, day-lit moments, with the royal eyes unclouded by the mist that hazed them each evening. At those dark times, he could be a bore to sit next to. But with his children, well, with his children, he was a fool who remembered youth, a wise fool who still found wonder in the world.
"Chancellor?"
Thaddeus started. He realized that they had both been sitting in silence. The messenger had been distracted by her fatigue just as he was caught up in random reveries. He felt the sharp point of the cheese knife where it pressed against his finger. He said,
"The king must hear all of this within the hour. You say that General Elaine sent you directly here. You have not spoken of this to the governors."
She answered crisply,
"My message was meant for King Leodan."
"Just as it should be."
Thaddeus tugged on an earlobe.
"Sit here a moment. I will arrange a meeting with the king. You have done us a great service."
The Chancellor pushed himself up to his feet. He still held the knife, but he began to move away as if he had forgotten about it and carried it with him absently. As he passed the messenger's chair and stepped behind her, he swung about. He flipped the knife around in his fingers and grasped the handle in a white-knuckled fist. At just the same moment that one hand clasped over the woman's forehead, the other one slit her neck from left side to right. He had not been sure whether the tool would suffice for this purpose, and he used more force than he had to. But the work was done. The messenger slumped forward without a word of protest. He stood for a moment just behind her, with the knife held out to one side, the whole blade of it and of the fist that held it stained a slow maroon. With conscious effort, he willed his hand open. The weapon clattered to the floor and then lay still. Thaddeus was not entirely the loyal servant of the king that he seemed. And for the first time in his life he had demonstrated this fact with a blood act that could not be rescinded. The hard truth of this stunned him. He fought to steady himself and direct his thoughts, to focus on details and action. He would have to send his servants away, and then he would dispose of this soldier's body and clean the mess. It would take the rest of the night to accomplish this, but he would not even have to leave his compound. There was a dungeon beneath where he stood now. He had only to drag the woman down the winding staircase that led to it, shove her inside, lock the door, and leave it to the rats, insects, and worms to clean her bones undisturbed. Dealing with the moral ramifications of what he had just begun would not be nearly as easy.
Chapter 4. Like all of the children of the noble houses, Oliver Akaran had been raised in opulence. He always woke to find his slippers resting in place on the floor beside him, and flower petals in the basin of scented water he washed his face in. From the moment he took solid food, each meal he had eaten had been prepared to the highest standards, with the best ingredients, with the effect on the palate considered down to the last detail. He had never walked into a cold room on a winter's day, never drawn his own bath or wet his hands washing clothes. He never even witnessed the washing of plates soiled by a meal. If asked, he would have had to create from fancy the process by which items were cleaned, mended, replaced. He had lived at the center of a massive delusion. It was a most pleasant one, in which the world functioned largely for his gratification. At 16 years of age, however, none of this stopped him from viewing the world through disgruntled eyes. Leaving his private quarters a week after the seashore ride with his father and siblings, the prince grabbed up his leather training slippers and flung his fencing vest over his shoulder. In the corridor outside his room, he strolled between guards that stood like statues at either side of his door, and then he passed down a row of actual mannequins that lined one wall. These life-sized figures were carved of pine wood down to the minutest human detail, sanded to textures as smooth as skin, and evocative of flesh over bone. They had been positioned in differing stances and wore military garb from the various nations. A Talayan runner, the wood stained to near black to mimic his skin color, an iron spear poised in the fingers of his right hand, a Cinevalian infantryman in scale armor, curving longsword at his belt, a horseman of the mean with his characteristic thick breastplate draped in hides that hung around him in tattered bands, a Vumu warrior adorned in eagle feathers, and Acacians in their various tidy uniforms, bare-armed with loose, flowing trousers under fine chain mail. Oliver's rooms had more objects of warfare than the king cared for. He had once pointed out that Acacia had overseen a largely peaceful empire for generations. But on this matter the prince did not mind his father's disapproval. His daily interactions with his peers were a more challenging jostle than his relationship with his father. Leodan no longer elbowed through life among a throng of young men. Oliver, on the other hand, had yet to come through his manhood trials. As he saw it, all of the higher pursuits his father enjoyed had been made possible by the bravery of men and women willing to bear arms. It had been their earlier military prowess that allowed their ancestors to take the feuding, disparate elements of the known world and unify them into a partnership of nations that benefited them all. How but through force could this have been achieved? How but through the threat of force could it be maintained? In angry moments, Oliver imagined his father trying to hold forth to that earlier rabble, to explain to them the virtues of peace and friendship. They would have laughed him away from the campfire. They would have kicked him into the cold, spat, and called him a coward. And then they would have commenced the snarling battle that decided things in this world. Sometimes, during these imaginings, Oliver came to his father's rescue, sword in hand. Other times he simply watched, It was not that he failed to love his father. He cared for him dearly. He hated that he thought such things. They came to him unbidden, no easier to submerge than the unexplained pangs of carnal desire that had plagued him the last couple of years. But this was also beside the point. What mattered was that the Akarans were the benevolent masters of a magnificent realm. They had been for 22 generations, and would be for much longer if Alava had any say in the future. That was why he took martial matters so seriously. The walk to the Mara training hall took only a few minutes, most of it downhill. The bulk of the palace, the town, the lurt, the island, and the sea around it stretched out before Alava. The receding scale of it was difficult to reckon with. The near buildings were hulking structures of clean Acacian architecture. Roads wound down in the switchback fashion the hillside's natural steepness required. Beyond the gates, figures on the visible bend of the main road were slow-moving pinpricks, like deer ticks crawling across a man's arm. The spires of the lower town were little more than sewing needles pointing upward, so tiny they could be squished between the thumb and forefinger. It was hard to imagine that all of it had begun with a simple fortress built by Edifus, a defensive structure perched high so that the nervous monarch could scan the seas around him in fear that his newly conquered subjects might yet unite against him. Flushed from the brisk walk, Alava entered the large, pillar-supported space. It was lit by oil lamps hung on the wall, or from three-legged stands, and by skylights cut in the ceiling that cast slanting beams down on the gray-white stone of the place. The scent of the burning oil was almost sweet, stronger than the smoky flavor given off by the stoves used to keep the chill at bay. He greeted his instructors, nodded at other youths entering with him, boys mostly, although a handful of girls attended also. They received military training on an even footing with their male counterparts. Indeed, women made up almost a quarter of the Acacian armed forces. For this Mara training, however, they were all children of aristocrats bound for high posts as officers and government officials. Many of them were from the Agnate, the privileged group that could verify an ancestral link to Edifus's family tree. The prince knew that previous Akaran rulers had formed tight bonds with their young peers. His grandfather, Grigulan, was said to have been constantly in the company of 13 male companions, dining and sleeping, ruling and wedding, in a close tangle. Though his peers were deferential to him, Alava found no such feeling of group connection. He tried to spurn the absence of it, and value his independence of mind and position. But he feared something was lacking in his character, something he seemed powerless to correct. Alava smiled when he saw Melio Sherat, a young man his own age, enter. Melio was the nearest thing the prince had to a friend. They had been born only a few weeks apart, and from their first classes together the kind intelligence in the boy's eyes drew Alava to him. For a while, when they were both 10, they spent days at a time hiding out in the palace labyrinth, playing a game wherein one of them became a storyteller and the other the main character in what invariably became a tale of warfare and adventure of mythic beasts slain and evil vanquished. Alava felt comfortable with Melio in a way he did not with others. Still, despite his fondness for the lad, the prince never fully dropped his aloofness with him, or anyone else. If anything, it had grown, as adolescents shifted and altered their bodies and emotions. So the smile that once would have been friendly changed into an expression harder to define. "Hello, prince," Melio said. "I hope the day finds you well." "It does," Alava said, looking past him as if something at the far end of the training grounds interested him. Melio combed the longish bangs of black hair back from his forehead with his fingers and good-naturedly copied Alava's examination of the other students as they arrived.
Have you been practicing your fifth form? I saw that Bitteran was coaching you on it last week. If you passed it, you could start spear training.
I'll pass it, Oliver said. You should worry about yourself. I'll help you with the fourth form if you need it.
You?
Milio asked, laughing. My royal tutor? He had a face that might go unnoticed in a room, except when he smiled. Then all the various components of his features fell into place as if they had been designed with only mirth in mind. The whiteness of his teeth beside his olive skin made him glow with health. Both boys knew that in matters martial, the ground between them was not even. Oliver may have been training at a higher Mara form than his peers, such was the long tradition, but Milio had been suggested for training as an elite. The elite was quite different than the Mara. It was an even smaller group, selected purely for ability, without regard for rank or social status. The suggestion that Milio might join them was an honor that meant the instructor saw inordinate skill in the young man.
Look, there's Heffron, Milio said. He's getting quite good. He fought Carver's father to a standstill the other day. You can be sure it surprised the old fellow.
As he spoke, Milio gestured at the boy in question with his chin. Heffron Anthalar was a year older than most of the others, taller by a head, with reddish hair that sprung in disheveled curls from his head. The Anthalars were also agnates, of a line that had intersected several times with the Akarans through marriage. Heffron could claim royal lineage. He could, in fact, count the steps between himself and the throne on the fingers of his two hands. He walked with his followers tight around him, a sycophantic group that clung to him because the status found in his shadow was greater than any of them could have managed singly. Heffron bowed on reaching the prince, a motion that his companions copied with less feigned and more genuine deference.
"Prince," he said, "ready to fight the ghosts?"
Oliver knew what he referred to in an instant and felt the cut of the barb. A peculiarity of his training was that after the initial lecture and demonstrations, Oliver and the other boys parted company. The others paired off and went at each other with the padded swords, sometimes using the wooden variety, which had no blade to cut but could still issue a painful rap or jab, or even break bones when wielded skillfully. Oliver, on the other hand, trained only with an instructor who further worked him through the classic forms, the teacher attuned to the minutest detail of his student's posture and positioning, the intake or exhalation of his breath, the position of his head, or even his eyes. Using the wooden swords, they fenced together in slow motions honed to the finest precision. In this, Oliver had thought himself special. His training had a purity that would always set him apart from the others. It was a gift to be envied. So he had believed, until Heffron undermined it all with a single question.
"Ghosts?" Oliver asked. "I don't believe in ghosts, Heffron. I do believe that the instructors know how best to train the nation's next king."
"Yes," the other said, "I suppose they do."
"Quite right, as ever."
As he turned away, his eyes canted upward in a signal to his companions. He said something Oliver could not hear, and the other youths moved away with amused murmurs. Oliver tried to forget Heffron in the hours that followed. The lessons began with a lecture. Today it was from the second instructor, Edvar, a bull-necked man of mixed heritage, his Candovian ancestry betrayed by the beryl stoutness of his torso. He talked about the technique of the sword soft block, a defensive tactic wherein one countered an opponent's attacks with the bare minimum of force necessary. "It was risky," he explained. "You did not want to underestimate the opponent's force, but it was a valuable maneuver in that you could use the opponent's energy to initiate your own moves, thereby starting the next motion with a boost before the enemy had recovered. It was an energy-saving method if one faced a long struggle, as had Goethe when she fought the twin brothers, Talak and Tullus and their three wolf dogs. After this, the pupils divided up to practice the forms. These were routines that derived from age-old reconstructions of specific sequences of moves by specific persons in ancient battles. The first was Oedipus at Carnae, when he fought singly against a tribal leader. The second was Alys, a woman from Ashenia who killed the madman of Caravan with only a short sword. It was a unique form, in that Oshenians themselves did not honor Alys as much as Acacians did. Indeed, the madman of Caravan was considered to be somewhat more of a hero to Oshenians, since he had fought to protect their old religions against the secular movement Alys championed. The third form was that of the knight Bathenry, who went to battle with devil's forks, short weapons similar to daggers but with long prongs attached alongside of the central blade. Skilled hands used these to snap opponents' swords. Other forms followed, each more complicated than the one preceding it, up until the tenth and most difficult, that of Telamathon against the five disciples of the god Relos. Alivor had his doubts as to whether Telamathon, the five disciples, or the god Relos ever existed, but he looked forward to learning the form. A large section of it, he knew, recounted how Telamathon fought weaponless and with one shoulder dislocated. Even so incapacitated, he managed to beat back his opponents with a dazzling whirlwind of aerial kicks. The other students were working through the fourth form. Alivor, as per tradition, worked on the fifth form, learning the method by which the priest of Araval went to work on the 20 wolf-headed guards of the rebellious cult of Andar. The prince had just begun the study of this. For most of his lesson, he stood holding the birchwood staff, listening, and trying to imagine the scene his instructor detailed. As usual, the form detailed an almost impossible triumph, the old priest managing to crack skull after canine skull with only a sapling for a weapon. Alivor sometimes felt the eyes of the others on him. At other times he could not help but glance at them, interspersed as they were among the pillars, almost 100 of them in total, so many pairs in the stop-start motion of sword play. Every now and then a student would get caught by another's winning strike. With the padded swords, this was almost a pleasure, a thing to be laughed at, yielding oaths and promises of revenge. Not so when the hard ashwood swords stung someone's thigh or jabbed unprotected ribs. Alivor was never prey to such contact, and he was keenly aware of it each time someone called out in pain. When the day's session concluded, the instructors left the students to return the weapons to their rightful places. Privileged sons and daughters that they were, they should still learn reverence for the tools of war. Alivor, once more mingling with the others, did the best he could to banter in a natural style. He tried to throw about casual comments, the jibes and jokes of youth. But what seemed to come effortlessly to the others was as concentrated an effort for Alivor as anything in his training. It was with a feeling of relief that he slipped on his soft leather boots, rose from the floor, and gathered up his training vest and slippers. As he passed a cluster of boys near the exit, Heffron rose from a squatting position. He spoke under his breath, ostensibly to the youth standing near him, but loud enough and at just the right moment for the prince to hear.
I wonder how you lose when you only fight the air, or how you win. Strange that some of us are measured against each other, while some are not measured at all.
The opening to the hallway was just a few steps away. Alivor could have been there and outside in just a few seconds. Instead, he spun on his heel.
What did you say? Oh, as I said, nothing, Prince. Nothing of consequence. If you have something to say to me, just say it. I just envy you, of course, Heffron said. You sword train, but you never get cracked atop the skull like the rest of us. Would you like to fence with me, then, if you think my training is lacking? No, of course. No.
A note of caution appeared in Heffron's voice. His eyes darted to his companions, checking to see whether he had overstepped himself, or if he should push farther.
I wouldn't want to be the one who bruised the royal flesh. Your father could have my head for that.
My father wants no such head as yours. And who says he would be able to touch me, much less bruise me?
Heffron looked sad, something Oliver would think on later, though he barely noticed it in the heat of the moment.
We don't need to do this, he said. I meant no offense. Your training is rightly different from ours. You will never need to fight in a real battle anyway, we all know that.
Though Heffron spoke these words with a measure of sincerity, Oliver noted only the aspects of it that seemed a taunt, an insult. The prince started toward the equipment rack.
We'll fence, just as you do with the others, with wooden swords. Hold nothing back. Touch me, if you can. You have my word, you will give no offense.
Properly suited up, a few moments later, the two youths faced each other inside a hushed circle created by the other students, many of whom glanced over their shoulders, worried lest an instructor return. Heffron had a deceptive style of swordplay. He did nothing with a clear and predictable rhythm. He changed his rate of movement and even the direction of his strike in mid-motion. He would parry in a certain manner for a time, his wrist loose, his sword making sweeping arcs. Just when Oliver had come to anticipate and almost find comfort in the rhythm of it, Heffron would change everything, mid-stroke. He would drop bodily an inch or two lower. His stroke would become a thrust. His arm would switch from a downward motion to a jab so quickly that the two differing motions seemed to have nothing to do with each other, one neither the precursor to nor the result of the other. For some time, Oliver managed to fend him off without taking a touch. He did so with motions slightly more frantic than he wished, quick jerks and clumsy shifts of his feet and exhaled breaths, convolutions of his torso that just barely kept him out of reach. The ash sword felt comfortable enough in his hands, but he realized that he rarely found a moment to drive an aggressive strike. He was all counter-movements. What he wished to do was find a still moment to fall into a familiar sequence from his training. He fixated on the 12th movement of the first form, wherein he would slip away from a sweeping strike coming in from the left, step forward and block the inevitable return, push his opponent's blade down and to the right, crossing beneath his knees, and then slice upward diagonally into the right side of his torso. With such a cut, Edifus had managed to spill his opponent's viscera in looping knots that caused the man to pause long enough to set his head in the perfect position to be lopped off a few seconds later. An unnecessary flourish, really, but one Oliver had often imagined. Three times he began this sequence, but each time Heffron stepped out of it and changed his attack. On the last instance, he did so with such speed that Oliver cringed beneath a round sweep that skimmed the crown of his head. Had he taken the force of this directly, he might well have been knocked unconscious. No instructor had ever swung at him like that. He heard one of the others say something, a jibe, followed by a rustle of laughter. He realized just how silent they had been up until then, no sound in the room save for the swish and shift of their slippers across the tiles, the grunts of their efforts and the dry cracks when the wooden blades met. Oliver found himself backing, barely able to slap away Heffron's blows, needing space and then space again. He expected to meet the wall of youths behind him, but they moved with him, the circles staying fixed around them. It even opened as the movement brought them to a pillar. He knocked the granite base of this with his foot. He half-lowered his sword, for a moment thinking this was reason enough to pause. He glimpsed the possibility that they might halt this exercise, smile, and joke about it, no damage done. But Heffron swung, his blade slicing below Oliver's chin and striking the stone pillar. The prince stumbled backward. He caught himself with his free hand and pivoted on it. Upright again, he remembered the anger that had started all of this. Heffron, the arrogant fool. It seemed absurd that he would strike at him that way,
as if he wished to shatter his windpipe. He caught sight of Melio, who at that moment stood on the far side of the ring, his face ridged with concern. That annoyed him also. He wanted no sympathy. He raised his sword above his head and yanked it down, wishing to pound Heffron beneath it. Even if the hit was blocked, he meant to press such weight behind it as to batter him down with fury alone. But Heffron seemed to know this was coming. He slid to the side of Alivor's downstroke. He snapped his sword in a quick blow that bit the prince just at the edge of his shoulder, at the joint where the bones met. From this the boy twirled away, swung around in a complete circle, and caught Alivor, who had frozen in a twist of pain, at the midpoint of the other arm, with a force great enough that a real sword would have severed the arm cleanly. Alivor cried out, but Heffron was not done. He drew his sword back into his chest and lunged forward, pushing his weight before him and thrusting his arms so that the blunt wooden point of his sword hit Alivor's chest at dead center. Already convulsed with two-armed pain, the force of this last strike rocked the prince back onto his heels and dropped him onto the mat. Heffron's smile lifted every component feature of his face into use. His eyes overflowed with such smugness that a single person could barely contain it. "You are armless, sir, not to mention dead. What a strange outcome. Who would have guessed it?" Moments later, Alivor surged out into air, red-faced and angry, more so at himself than at Heffron. How foolish of him! He had lowered himself by acknowledging Heffron's taunts, in challenging him, by losing so completely, and, almost worst of all, in showing all of them his frustration. Behind this, he knew he had played a hand he had not needed to. All the mystery of his possible skill had vanished in a few strokes. He knew they were all surrounding Heffron even now, clapping him on the back, praising him, laughing at their dandy prince. How could he ever go back there again and dance through his choreographed motions while all the others watched him from the corners of their scornful eyes? Melio caught up with him as he pounded up a long staircase. "Alivor!" he called. "Wait for me!" Twice he touched the prince's elbow, only to have his hand ripped away. At the top of the stairs, Melio jumped in front of him, threw his arms around him, and dragged him to a halt. "Come on! You care too much about this. Don't do it. Heffron's nothing." "He's nothing?" Alivor asked. "Nothing? If he's nothing, then what am I? The king's son? Alivor, don't walk away, and don't pity yourself. Do you think that little fight matters? I will tell you something." Melio drew back a little, but pressed the palms of his hands on the other's shoulders, as if indicating that he was letting go but not yet doing so. "Okay, so the truth is you are no match for Heffron. He is good. No, wait, but don't let that bother you. Alivor, he envies you in everything. Don't you know that? His swagger is a pretense. In truth, he wishes he were you. He follows you with his eyes, always. He listens to every word said by or about you. At lessons, when he sits in the back of the class, he pins his eyes to the back of your head as if he wished to drill inside you." "What are you saying?" "I'm saying that Heffron is a thin person. He knows this himself, and he envies you. You are a prince, and your family is wonderful. You have a beautiful sister. Okay, I am joking with you. It's true, but I am joking. Heffron may grow into an enemy, or he may yet be a great friend. But for now, give him no feeling of triumph. Forget about that." Melio motioned vaguely at something behind him. "Come back tomorrow as if nothing happened. Joke about it. Let him know that the small things he can do to you wash off like mud on your boots." The air had grown chillier with the approach of dusk, and both young men felt it fill the silence. Melio withdrew his palms and rubbed his bare arms with them. Alivor looked away, his gaze settling on a square of fuchsia sky,
framed between the cold shadows of two buildings. The silhouettes of three birds flew through the space like darts in pursuit of one another. Alibur heard himself say, "It just makes me look so stupid. I am mad that I let it happen. Made it happen. You don't know how it is for me." Milio did not disagree. A few moments passed in silence, and then the two of them, responding to the cold, mounted the next set of stairs and progressed slowly up. "Everyone loses a duel on occasion, and all of them back there know that. But how many of them could..." He searched for the words to say what he had to delicately. "Well, how many of them could embarrass themselves like you just did, and find the courage to shrug it off? That's another way to show strength, whether they ever admit to noticing it or not. And do not pout. The expression does not suit you. Alibur, you are skilled with a sword, and your traditional forms are better than anyone's. It's just that you know only the forms. Actual fencing is about making us adapt them, about splicing them together, forcing us to make up unthought-of combinations in an instant. You must let them flow together so quickly that it happens in a different place than conscious thought. Like when you knock a knife off a tabletop and manage to snatch it before it hits the ground. You cannot think about doing that. It just happens. That is what you must do in fighting. And then your mind is free to deal with other things, like just how are you going to place an upstroke in that bastard's nutsacks? Just how did you become so wise?" Alibur asked, not entirely kindly. Milio mounted the top of the staircase and turned to face him. He grinned. "I read it in the manual. I know a fair bit of poetry, too. The girls like that. Now look, we'll fence together sometimes. I won't let you off easy, of course, but we will teach each other. We can work through the fourth form, as you suggested. There is much we can teach each other. How about that?" "Maybe," Alibur said, but he knew already what his actual answer was. He just was not ready to give it so easily. Chapter 5. It was not just the rumors of a marauding army on the loose, not just the report about the destruction at Vedus. These were the type of exaggerated tales General Leka Alain had rightly ignored before. This time was different. An entire patrol had been lost somewhere in the white expanse of the Mean. That was not so easily explained away. Something was truly in motion out there. He could not sleep or eat or think of anything other than shadows hidden behind the blowing whiteness. He had already sent a messenger to the king to communicate such facts as he possessed, but he knew he could not wait for a response. He decided to take what action he could. Leka roused his army from the cocooned warmth of the fortress of Cathgirgan. He marched them out into the slanting light of the northern winter, across the glacial skin of the Mean Plateau. At the eastern edge of the Mean is a vast tundra called the Barrens, undulating and irregular, treeless, both because of the wind-lashed nature of the place and because what woodland there once was had been harvested centuries before. Travel across it was difficult at the best of times. In midwinter it was especially perilous. Sleds harnessed to teams of dogs cut tracks before the army, pulling along the bulk of camp supplies and food, enough to sustain their 500 human souls for at least 6 weeks. The soldiers marched on their own heavily booted feet. They wrapped themselves in woolen garments with outer shells of thick leather, their weapons secured to their bodies to facilitate movement. They wore mittens made from the tubed pelts of rabbits. They got as far as the outpost at Hardith without unexpected difficulty. They camped around the earthen structure for 2 days. This was much to the bewildered pleasure of the soldiers stationed there, men whose official duty was to supervise traffic on the road, but whose real struggle was that of daily survival and extreme isolation. The outpost marked the western edge of the Barrens. Farther to the west, the land dropped into a series of wide, shallow bowls in which patches of fir woodland remained. 3 days beyond Hardith, a blizzard swept down from the north and attacked their huddled mass. It pounced on them like a wolverine, pinned them to the ground, and tried to tear them apart. They lost the road and spent an entire day trying to find it, to no avail. The snow piled into high, serpentine ridges that rolled like ocean waves and made navigation impossible. They could not chart the passage of the sun, nor spot any of the night's stars. Lika instructed his men to progress by dead reckoning. This was a tedious process that left the bulk of the army standing still for long periods, never a good thing in such conditions. Each evening, the general tried to choose a campsite near natural protection, a ridge of hills or a tree cover, as they now found stands of pines in the hollows. Soldiers hacked fuel and built windbreaks. Once the campfires were strong enough, they dragged whole trees into the flames. They stood around these explosive furnaces, their faces red and sweating from the blaze, eyes stung with smoke even as the wind howled at their backs. No matter how big the fire during the early evening, it had invariably faltered during the night. Ashes and charred bits of wood swept across the snowscape by the wind. On breaking out of the frozen crust each morning, the soldiers spent hours finding one another under the drifts, digging out and prodding the dogs to motion. On the 22nd day, they woke to a brutal wind blowing down from the north. Ice crystals screeched sideways and struck skin like hurled fragments of glass. They had barely put the old camp behind them when one of the scouts stumbled back to the main column and asked to speak to the general. He had, in fact, nothing concrete to report. The land ahead was flat as far as he could ascertain. He believed they had moved out onto a gradual slope that would bring them to Tahalian. But there was something that troubled him. There was a sound in the air and in the frozen ground beneath him. He had been able to hear it only because he was alone, outside of the noise of the moving army and beyond the sleds. As he returned past the sled dogs, he could see that they heard it as well and were troubled by it. The general spoke close to the man so the wind would not steal his words. "What sort of sound?" The scouts seemed to have feared this question.
"Like breathing."
Lika scoffed.
"Breathing? Don't be mad. What's the sound of breathing in weather like this? Your ears are damaged."
The general reached for the man's head and tried to yank back his hood as if he would inspect his ears right there. The scout allowed this, preoccupied, dissatisfied with his own answer.
"Or like a heartbeat. I'm not sure, sir. It's just there."
The general showed no sign that he thought the man's message of particular import, but sometime later he walked away from his officers to think. Even if the man's story was only illness creeping into him, it was still a danger. Scouts predict more things than just the lay of the land. Perhaps they should hold up where they were, or retrace their tracks back to the last camp, where there was still an ample supply of fuel for the fires. They could wait out the storms, even eating into the food reserves if necessary. They were near Tahalian after all. Even if Hanish Mean was up to something, they would still have to be welcomed with a pretense of kindness. It was because he stood at the edge of the column that he first heard the sound, if heard is the right word. With the noise of the troops behind him, and the trudge of their feet and the scrape of a sled passing nearby, he did not truly hear through his ears. He felt the sound, as if the bones of his rib cage captured a low vibration and amplified it in his chest. He took a few steps away from the column and sank to one knee. One of his officers called to him, but he thrust up a clenched fist and the man fell silent. Lika knelt, trying to feel the sound captured inside him, to block out the howl of the wind and friction of his hood across the sides of his head. When he quieted all this as best he could, he found what he was searching for. It was faint, yes, but undeniable. Like breathing, true enough. Like a heartbeat, yes. The scout had not lied. There was a rhythm to it, a throbbing time, a conscious, measured reason to it. He spun on his knee and yelled for the ranks to form up. He ran back to them, shouting for the column to draw tight, shields up and facing outward, weapons to hand. He instructed the archers to quiver their arrows and unsheathe blades, not victim to the wind and better suited to close quarters. He told the sled drivers to circle them within the troops and huddle the dogs. The same officer who had called to him before asked him what he had discovered. He met the young man's eyes and gave a simple answer. There's a war drum beating. Once the army had been formed into one defensive wedge, and 500 pairs of eyes stared out into the increasing fury of the north, then, finally, they all heard it. For a long hour, that was all they did. The sound throbbed constant behind the wind, which was heavier now, with large flakes of snow that stuck fast to their clothes and shields and fur-lined fringes, and even, eventually, to the chill skin on their faces, rendering their still forms like some elaborate snow sculptures. At some point, the reverberation mingled with the general's heartbeat. That was why he was struck breathless at the shock of it. When the noise stopped, it simply ceased. In the moments afterward, Lika knew he had made a mistake. Whatever drumbeat was out there had been doing so not for hours, but for days. It had been there for weeks, perhaps, before he was able to distinguish it. How could something like that have eluded him? He was not to contemplate this question for long, however. A creature hurtled through the screen of blown snow. It rampaged forward, a horned thing, woolly and huge, some sort of man astride it, a figure clothed in skins and furs, a spear raised in one hand, a yell emanating from his unseen mouth. The beast smashed into the ranks of men just to one side of the general's guard. It tore through them as if the soldiers were of no consequence. It squashed some and knocked others aside without diminishing its speed or altering its course. It vanished through the far side of the troops as quickly as it appeared. In the few seconds the general had to contemplate the scene, he counted 10 dead and twice as many more writhing on the blood-splashed snow. A hand on his shoulder spun him around, and he observed, as he had already known he would, that the rider had not been alone. The rest of them materialized all at once, as if the snow had thinned to better his view. There were so many of them, an alien multitude like nothing he had seen before. He suspected that the horror of it would be the last thing he took in with living eyes, and he knew that even if his message got through, he had failed to adequately warn the king and the people of the empire of the hideous threat massed against them. Chapter 6. Late in the evening, Leodan Akaran heard someone enter his private chamber. He did not look up, but he knew who it was. The chancellor's clipped footfalls had a unique rhythm to them, something that the king had once pinpointed as a stiffness in the right leg. A servant had just lit his mist pipe and withdrawn. The pungent scent of the drug was, at that moment, the only thing that mattered. A phantom had clung to the back of his head throughout the day, a hunger he envisioned as a bat-like creature that huddled around the contours of his skull, its claws sharp and thin as curved needles where they pierced his flesh and found purchase by anchoring into the bone. It had gripped him during his morning meetings, left him for a time during an hour spent with Corinne, but returned with sharpened, malicious claws throughout the evening.
It prodded him as he dined, and gnawed at him as he put Dariel down to sleep. When Dariel had asked him for a story, Leodan had grimaced. It was just for a moment, a second of creviced physical expression that he regretted instantly. The boy had not even seen it, but it remained a nagging shame that he could long for his own vices while still in the company of his children. Where would he be without his children? Without Mina, who still, for precious months more, perhaps, wanted him to spin tales for her, and Dariel, who hung on his words with a trusting certainty the father knew time would shatter. He would be an empty shell without them. Shame on him for letting a moment with them pass in distraction. He told Dariel the story he asked for, and then he stood a few extra moments beside the boy's door, listening to his slumbering breath and regretting his own weaknesses. All this was earlier. His feeble penance was complete. Now the pipe sat on the low table before him. It was an intricate confusion of glass tubes and water-filled chambers and leather hoses, one of which the king held between the fingertips of both hands. He placed the narrow bit of it between his teeth, touching it with his tongue. He inhaled gently at first. Then, as he tasted the bitter, putrid sweetness of the mist, his cheeks caved against his jawbones. The pipe bubbled and sputtered. He stayed huddled forward, eyes closed, aware that his chancellor stood near him, but not caring. This was nothing Thaddeus had not seen before. When he fell back against the cushions of his couch, he exhaled a slow plume of green vapor. The creature on his head plucked out its talons, one by one. It faded into nothingness, taking with it the gray weight that he had carried with him like a granite cloak throughout the day. The opiate numbed the edges of the world. He felt no barbs. Instead, he was filled with blurred tranquility, a warm feeling of connection with the millions of people throughout his empire tied to the same drug. Peasant farmers and blacksmiths, municipal guards and rubbish collectors, miners, slavers, in this one thing he was the same as them all. It was, to the reasoning of his muted mind, a secret offering made for their forgiveness. He opened his eyes, clouded now and veined reddish brown. What news has the Chancellor to share? Thaddeus had seated himself on a nearby divan. He sat with his legs crossed at the knee and a glass of port pinned between his right thumb and forefinger. The king eyed the small vessel, transfixed by something about the movement of the liquid against the glass, the stain it left as Thaddeus swirled it. He listened as the Chancellor apprised him of the preparations for the Oshenian delegation. They were prepared, he said, to impress upon the foreigners both their strength and wealth, and to extend a cautious hand of welcome. If the Oshenians confirmed that they acknowledged Acacian hegemony, everything would be in place to respond positively to them, if such was the king's wish. Leodan nodded. It was his wish, but he knew that several times before Oshenia had nearly formed an alliance with Acacia, only to have it scuttled by some minor dispute. Everything he had thus far heard about the young Prince Igeldan was promising, but still there were aspects of such an alliance that he did not wish to think about. He changed the subject, although his thoughts did not stray far from the things that troubled him. The other day, Mina asked about the retribution. What did you tell her? Nothing. Why should she learn that she has the blood of mass murderers in her veins? It was long ago, and we are no longer like that. You are right that it was long ago, Thaddeus said. 22 generations. What child can comprehend that? The king recalled that when Mina had asked the question, he had glimpsed something less than faith in his daughter's eyes, less than complete acceptance of his claims. And was not that astute of her? He had, after all, uttered yet another barefaced lie. The retribution has no bearing on our lives? A blatant untruth spoken with a silvered tongue. How much longer could he get away with such things? It was not just Mina, of course, who had begun to question. Alliver had for some time carried an uncertainty and distrust behind his eyes that seemed ever ready to burst forth. The Chancellor said, I should mention that the convener called for the governors to intercede in the case the Prios miners have filed against the—
Must I deal with that? I hate anything to do with the mines.
Fine. We can let the governors handle it. There is something that they cannot handle, though. Thaddeus pursed his lips, waited for the king to meet his gaze. The League representatives want to verify that you are truly going to reject the Lothan Aklun demand to increase the quota. The statement was nearly enough to clear the king's head of the drug's dulling effects. The Lothan Aklun, the agreement known as the quota. These two things were the great disguised sin of the Akaran Empire. Leodan sucked on his pipe. He had a momentary wish that this matter be handled by the governors. In truth, these representatives from the provinces, based in the thronging city of Alicia, handled most of the practical matters of the empire. But Tinhatan, the early king who was in many ways the chief architect of the Akaran Empire, had written the quota guidelines with explicit simplicity. Control, authority, responsibility. All rested on the monarch's shoulders, a secret known by many but owned by him alone. For that reason, the management of it was handled by the palace. It was paid for through a separate budget and accounted separately from any other arm of the government. It was not spoken of, except in closed circles, and the actual machinations of it happened far away, unseen by the king, although often imagined. No matter how he studied the ancient texts, the exact details of how the arrangement had been reached seemed jumbled to Leodan. The substance, however, could be understood. Tinhatan, having inherited his father's newly won throne and outliving his brothers, found himself prosecuting wars on several fronts. The wars of distribution, as they were called, marked a strained and tumultuous time. His former ally, Hawk Meenish of the Mean, was now an enemy. He no longer trusted his faithful sorcerers, the Santoth. Provincial rebellions flared up like wildfires on the Acacian hills during the summer. His own understanding of the world was warped and horrific, and he struggled with a belief that any word uttered from his mouth might change the fabric of existence. He was a Santoth as well, the greatest of them. But the burden of the magic on his tongue had become a torture to control. Into this came a new threat from across the gray slopes. There was a power, Tinhatan learned, greater than his own. They were called the Lothan Aklun. They were of the other lands, outside the known world, separated from them by a great ocean. They were a complete mystery to the early king. Their power was nothing, really, but a claim. But Tinhatan did not want another enemy at that time. He made overtures of peace with them, suggesting trade and mutual gain instead of conflict. The Lothan Aklun not only jumped at the offer, they proposed specifics Tinhatan could not have imagined on his own. The agreement must have seemed a bargain at the time. The Lothan Aklun promised not to attack the war-ravaged land and agreed to only ever trade with Akarans.
All they needed to assure this beneficence was a yearly shipment of child slaves, with no questions asked, no conditions imposed on what they did with them, and with no possibility that the children would ever see Acacia again. In return for this, they offered Tinhardin the mist, a tool that, they promised, he would find most helpful in sedating his fractious wards. It was fine-tuned later, but on these basic terms the deal was agreed. Since then, thousands upon thousands of the known world's children had been shipped into bondage, and millions under Akaran rule had given over their lives and labors and dreams to the fleeting visions brought on by the mist. The same drug Leodan Akaran inhaled nightly. Such was the truth of Acacia.
Demand?
Leodan finally asked.
You call it a demand?
In tone, yes, my lord. It does have the ring of belligerent certainty to it.
Lothan, belligerence is nothing new, Leodan said. It's nothing new. They already have my people's souls. What more do they want? The Lothan Oklun are no better than any of the riffraff surrounding us. The miners, the merchants, the league themselves. None of them is content from one moment to the next. I may have never set eyes on a Lothan, but I know them well. Tell the League to take this message to them. The quota stays as it always has been. The agreement was binding into perpetuity, made before my time to stretch beyond it. I do not accept any change now or ever.
He said this with finality, but he did not seem to like the silence Thaddeus responded with.
There is something else we should speak about, Leodan said.
I received a letter this morning from Lika Helene of the Northern Guard. He had it sent to a merchant in the lower town who got it to me through the house servants. All very unusual.
Yes, quite odd. Thaddeus cleared his throat, first softly, and then through several louder coughs.
What has the soldier to say?
It was a strange letter, full of import but vague on details. He wanted to know if I had received a messenger he sent earlier, a Lieutenant Zara. By the sound of it, this messenger was dispatched with some grave message.
Thaddeus watched the king.
Have you received such a message?
You know the answer to that. It would have come to me through you.
Of course, but I have heard nothing of this. Did Leica reveal the details of the message in the letter?
No, he doth not trust the written word.
He should not. Once written, anyone could read it.
The king's eyes moved slowly, heavily. They swung around on the chancellor and studied him, clouded by the drug, but still able to focus. The man's face was calm, although tense across the forehead.
Yes, perhaps. I do wonder why he chose to correspond with me instead of through the governor. I know he has no fondness for Rialis Neptus. I do not either, for that matter.
Do you know that Rialis used to write me at least twice yearly, extolling his virtues and hinting that he should be recalled from the mean and given some higher appointment here in Acacia, as if I want him sulking around the palace. He points out that he is of pure Acacian ancestry, says the climate of the mean damages his health. I cannot argue with that. Really, it is a miserable place. Anyway, Lika wished to communicate directly to me, and that makes me curious. Where is this Zara?
Thaddeus lifted his shoulders to his ears, then dropped them.
I know nothing, but even in these peaceful times ill things happen. It is the dead of winter. That means little here, but in the highlands of the mean the weather would be most foul. How was she meant to travel? On horseback or down the river, ask?
I don't know, he said.
Let me take care of this, Thaddeus said. Put it out of your mind until I have looked into it. I will send an armed envoy north to meet with Lyca. By your leave, I will give them the king's rights, so that they may travel swiftly and always have fresh horses. We will hear from them within a month, maybe less if they sail to Oshenia and take the short land route, 25 days at most, and then you will know everything. Thaddeus paused and waited for the king's response. It was little more than a grunt of affirmation, but it seemed to satisfy the chancellor. He sipped from his glass. And then you will see that it was nothing serious at all. Lyca has always prickled with suspicions about the mean, but when has it yet amounted to anything?
Things are different now, the king said.
Heberin Mean was a reasonable man, but he is dead. His three sons are a different matter. Hanish is ambitious. I saw that in his eyes even as a boy when he visited the city. Meander is pure spite, and Thassarin is a mystery. My father was sure that we would never be able to trust them. He made me swear I would not fall to that weakness. Trust. You also used to tell me I did not worry enough. Together, you and I conceived plans for all manner of tragic events. Remember? Thaddeus smiled. Of course I do. It is my job, too. In youth, I saw danger everywhere. But Acacia has never been stronger. I mean that, my friend.
I know you do, Thaddeus.
The king turned his gaze up toward the ceiling. Soon I will rouse all the children and take them on a voyage. We will visit each province of the empire. I will try to convince them that I am their beneficent king, and they will try to convince me that they are my loyal subjects. And perhaps the illusion will go on for some time yet. What say you to that? That sounds like a fine thing, Thaddeus said. That would make your children very happy. Of course, their uncle would accompany us as well. They love you as much as they do me, Thaddeus.
The other man took a moment to respond.
You honor me unduly.
The king sat repeating this statement in his head for some time, finding comfort in it even as he drifted away from its original context. He had said something similar once to Alira.
What had it been? You love me unduly.
That was what he had said.
Why had he said that? Because it was true, of course.
He had explained as much to her one evening a few days before their wedding. He had drunk too much wine and listened to too many speeches praising him. He could not take it any more, so he had pulled his bride-to-be to the side and told her she should know things about him before they were married. He confessed to her all that he knew about the crimes of the empire, the old ones and the ones still done in his father's name, the ones that would likely continue in his name. He poured it all out, tearful and pathetic and even belligerent, sure that she would shrink from him, almost hoping that she would turn away and reject him. Surely a good woman would, and he had no doubt of her goodness. How surprised he was by her response then. She drew close to him and tilted her lovely, large-eyed face up toward his. There was no surprise on her features, no remorse or judgment. She said, "A king is the best and worst of men." Of course. Of course. She pushed her lips against his, so soft and full of hungry pressure that they took his breath away. That, perhaps, was the moment they were actually married, the moment the agreement between them was sealed. It was hard for him to decipher now which aspect of her love he was most drawn to. Was it the fact that she could forgive him all of it and love him because she understood his ultimate goodness? Or was it that she betrayed that she was just as capable of overlooking the truth and living a lie as he? Either way, having confessed to her and received her blessing, he loved her completely. He would never have been able to fulfill his role as monarch without her approval. This might or might not have been a good thing for the world, but to a man as unsure of rule as he had been, her devotion had been a great gift. "Perhaps I do, Thaddeus," Leodan said, responding belatedly to his statement. "Perhaps I honor you unduly. We all make that mistake at times. But what harm does it do?" He did not hear the Chancellor's response, if indeed he offered any. He closed his eyes and felt the sensation of being pressed against an invisible wall. This mist had built in him, filled him. Now, the moment of letting go of the physical world was finally his. This moment always came to him as pressure, as if his chest lay flat against a stone, and a great force behind him gradually ground him into it. Just when he felt he could take the weight no more, he started to slip through the stone, to merge with it, and pass through as if it were porous and he in liquid form. On the other side, Alira waited for him. The temporary delusion he craved, almost more than true life. He went to her in reverence. Chapter 7. Riolos Neptos believed he had found a method whereby he could keep track of everyone who came into and went out of the northern fortress of Cathgirgan. He believed such surveillance was essential for a governor, especially one with such a tentative grip on power as he. He had ordered a single sheet of glass cast in the furnaces at the base of the fortress. He knocked out a portion of the granite wall in his office and set the pane to form one enormous window. The glass was taller than a man and as wide as he could stretch his narrow arms out to either side. The workmanship was imperfect. It was uneven in thickness, milky in some places, and dotted throughout with air bubbles. But there were a few patches of true clarity. Riolus had located each through long hours of inspection. Alone in his chambers, he would press his forehead to the pane. More often than not, the touch of the glass would bring a chill on and fuel his cough, a torment that had racked his bird-frail chest all his life. For a time, he even took to stretching out on the floor. A ribbon of glass along the lower edge of the pane distorted the world in such a way that he could study the entrance to the military headquarters at his leisure, and thus keep track of just who came and went in Lika Elaine's world. The best vantage came when he stood on a footstool and gazed down with a one-eyed squint that provided a view of the full reach of the western wall and the gate at its center. From this spot, he had watched General Elaine's troops march out in defiance of his direct orders. From the same spot, he observed the arrival of the second of the Mean Brothers, Mayander, some weeks later. Riolus pulled back from the glass. He was chilled again. The fortress was heated by steaming pools of hot water that bubbled up from the earth. An intricate network of pipes and air ducts channeled the warmth throughout the labyrinthine structure. The Cathgirgan engineers claimed it was a wonder of complicated craftsmanship, but in truth, the place was never warm enough. He sometimes suspected that his chambers were intentionally denied a full measure of heat, but he had no way of proving this. He circled his desk 1 1/4 times, then walked to the bookshelved wall and trailed a finger over the spines of the volumes there. Dusty tomes, full of records, accounting documents, and gubernatorial journals kept since the first installment of Acacian hegemony in the satrapy. His father had treated these records with sober reverence. He tried to instill the same in his only son, to no avail. Riolus was only the second generation of his family to oversee the mean. Not a long tenure in office, by Acacian standards. On the demise of the previous governing family, his father had been sent north in punishment for some malfeasance Riolus could not even recall any more. As the years passed, the other governors came to take the Neptos family for granted. The Akarans all but ignored them. It galled him that he was expected to pay indefinitely for a crime no one could even name. It tormented him that the outside world had no understanding of his razor-sharp mind, somehow held captive inside his stunted form, betrayed on every occasion by his jaw's tendency to freeze up at just the wrong moments. If others would just see beyond these outward defects, they would realize that he was wasted on this posting. Riolus was fond of saying that the giver rewards her worthies, but he had yet to see any evidence that the divine forces in the world had even noted his existence. After 10 years of being overlooked, Riolus became a fertile ground for intrigue. The elder mean brother had been quick to take advantage of this. Hanish was an eloquent speaker, a handsome man who spoke with such composure behind his gray eyes that one could not help but trust in him. Coming from his mouth, the strange belief system of the mean seemed no thing of fancy at all. The world of the living was transient, Hanish had explained, but the force that was the Tunish Never was constant. The Tunish Never was composed of all the worthy men of his race who had once lived and breathed, but did so no longer. It was their life force lingering outside their mortal vessels. It was the palpable energy of their rage, proof that the dead mattered more than the living. Life was the curse inflicted upon a soul before it rose to a higher plane. Like the body that is separate from the spirit within it and yet causes that spirit all manner of pain, so the fate of the living caused the ancestral core no end of suffering. The living kept the dead chained to them, and in ignorance of it made the afterlife a burden when it should have been the sweet fulfillment of life's journey. The ancestors, Hanish had claimed, implored him to ease their torture. When the governor had asked just what it was that the Tunish Never wanted, and exactly how were they to be freed of this suffering, Hanish had squeezed his shoulder as if they were close companions. He had a way of switching from a most serious tone to a casual one at a moment's notice. I do know that there are changes to be made to the order of the living world. That is the work I was born for. And you, Riolus Neptos, are an agent of my enemy. This also had been said lightly, but the list of crimes perpetuated by Acacia's hegemony seemed long and foul when Hanish had detailed it. What nation did not suffer beneath their rule? From the pale men of the north to the black ones of the south, from east to west, so many different peoples, scores of races of men, all suffered grave injustices. Generations had lived and died under the yoke of Acacian peace, but the mean had never forgotten who their enemy was. Now, finally, Acacia had a king grown lax enough that they could strike. Hanish believed that Leodan was the weakest heir in the long chain of his family's history. A new age could begin with a new calendar to mark the day, with new concepts of justice, with a redistribution of wealth, with privileges finally in the hands of those who had so long labored for other men's gain. There was little in this that Riolus could refute. He was, after all, in a prime position to know just how deeply Acacia taxed its allies. Riolus could not even remember just when the Mean brothers had brought him into their confidence, but he did recall his incredulity at the claims that Hanish made. He had said his League allies were more powerful than the Akarans. They had grown frustrated with the Akarans and angry with Leodan. They believed the king wanted to break the quota and abolish the mist trade. Because of this, they had decided his fate. He would be removed and replaced by another, willing to more faithfully meet their needs. Hanish claimed that this had happened twice before in the 22 generations since Tinhardin. But this was different. The king was not merely being removed so that his son, younger, more easily molded and controlled, could take his place. This time, the Lothan Aklun wanted the entire line extinguished and a new dynasty established with the Mean upon the throne. That was why Hanish had at his disposal a strange race of people willing to march across the ice fields and make war on the Mean's behalf. That was why he possessed new weapons that hurled flaming balls of pitch like the sun, or that tossed boulders. Add to this a hidden Meanish army that had been hard at training in the mountains to the north of Tahalian, unknown to the outside world. With these tools and several other surprises, Hanish promised to sweep down upon an unsuspecting world and take it apart, piece by piece. The brothers had alluded to various positions of stature Riolus might occupy in the reshaped world they envisioned, but as yet he had seen no rewards. He had hoped to prove himself useful. Unfortunately, this business with Lika had not gone as he wished. He knew that the general's army had been mysteriously massacred, but he was not at all sure if this would bring Mayander the pleasure it should. After all, Riolus's charge had been to keep the general caged and to do what he could to hide the foreigner's arrival. He had failed on both accounts. Mayander entered the governor's chambers with a visible disdain for the formalities due an Acacian official. He walked past the secretary, who was preparing to announce him, and strode into the room with clipped steps that seemed both casual and sharp enough to split the stones beneath his boots. Mayander was several inches taller than his host. He was broad in the shoulders, with strength that showed in movements of his muscled thighs and in the sinewy bulges of his forearms and in the contours of his neck. He wore his hair long. Below the shoulders, the straw-gold strands of it washed daily in icy water and combed out. An unusual thing, for most Meanish men let their hair knot and walked with a nest of snakes cascading down their shoulders. He was, in all outward forms, a model figure for the rough-hewn, virile men of his race, strapped into garments of tanned leather, legs covered by fitted trousers. Mayander pulled off his fur-lined gloves and tossed them down on a table, making a loud thwack as they hit. He did a quick survey of the room, pausing on the window.
"So, this is your window," he said,
inspecting the sheet of glass. He spoke Acacian with the guttural tones of his native language, sounds that had always offended Riolus's ear.
"The guards joked with me on the way in. When I instructed them to send you word of my arrival, one of them said that you already knew, since you always had one eye pressed against this glass. Another said that you seem not to realize that one can see both into and out of glass. Such impertinence, Governor, should not be allowed."
Riolus flushed. The basic fact that he would be visible to people outside had never occurred to him. He imagined the absurdity of his image viewed from outside, twisted into different contortions, those below watching him from the corners of their eyes, hiding smirks, laughing at him. And just like that, with a few casual words, he was made to feel a complete fool. He recalled the time when the Mean Brothers spoke to him as befit his office. But all that had changed. He had no idea how to regain his former stature. In fact, he increasingly suspected that he had never held any. Meander turned from the window. The man's eyes were strikingly gray. He did not so much look at someone as aim at them. Never, the governor thought, had he known a person to stare so fixedly, with such undisguised ill will. His gaze was that of a child upon a beetle he was about to squash beneath his heel.
"Do you know what happened to Elaine's army?"
Riolus was not generally a fluent speaker. Before Meander, he became a sputtering mess, which he was sure gave the wrong impression. Fortunately, Meander was more interested in talking himself than in giving a true interrogation. As he related it, Numrek scouts sent out to clear the way before the bulk of their nation had spotted the general's column. Unseen, they shadowed them for several days until they were positioned for ambush. They swept in on them upon the tailwind of a clearing storm and slaughtered them down to the last man and woman.
"You will be glad to hear that the Numrek are as skilled at killing as they claimed," Meander said. "They welcomed the test Elaine's army gave them. It warmed them, they said."
He turned and strolled around the room, directionless. He had three thin plates of hair that stretched from the crown of his head down to the left side. Into two, ribbons of blue were woven. Into the third, a leather strap studded with silver beads. Riolus knew that these were some primitive accounting system, the blue standing for 10 men killed, the leather strap for 20. Or was it the other way around? The governor could not remember.
"I have never seen anything quite like this Numerak army. They absorb and spit out everything they come up against. Their women and children take as much joy in slaughter as the men. I doubt very much that the combined forces of Acacia could match them on an open field."
"Then it was all for the best," Riolus said. "The giver provides for all worthies. A great success."
Meander did not like being led.
"Do not get ahead of yourself. You failed to keep your general shackled. You sat at your window here as he marched out to threaten everything my brother has been planning for years now. The outcome was not that bad, true, but you have forced us to speed up our plans. And is it true that your general sent out messengers, several of them?"
"Oh, he did, but not to worry. I had them all hunted and slain."
"Not true. One of them got through. One of them met with the king's chancellor, Thaddeus Clegg."
"Oh,"
Riolus said.
"Yes. Oh. Again, however, you have been saved by a piece of fortune."
He paused to let Riolus squirm a moment and then said,
"Thaddeus is conflicted enough so that he may not see his interests as aligned with Leodan's."
Riolus's mouth formed an oval.
Conflicted?
"Just so,"
Meander said. He reached down and pushed the tips of his fingers through olives set in a bowl on Riolus's desk, imported delicacies not easy to come by in the mean. He popped a few in his mouth and watched the governor.
"Actually, Riolus, the reasons for his conflicted state of mind intersect with your own situation. Would you like me to explain?
Riolus nodded, hesitant, but too curious to refuse. Meander spoke as he chewed. He asked Riolus to step back in time with him and to imagine Leodan and Thaddeus as they were in their youth. Imagine the young prince, dreamy, idealistic, indecisive in his acceptance of the power he was being groomed to wield, smitten by a young beauty, Alira, who seemed of more import to him than his throne. Beside him, his chancellor, resolute, confident, disciplined, a gifted swordsman, ambitious in the ways that Leodan was not.
Leodan was never exactly a jewel in his father's eye,
Meander said, grinning. Gridulan, he claimed, thought his son weak. But a son is a son. Gridulan had no other. He could not be denied. This is why Gridulan did the best he could to harden Leodan, even as he watched Thaddeus from the corner of his eye. He wanted his son to have a strong chancellor, but he had reason to fear Thaddeus's gifts. Thaddeus was an agnate, after all. He could trace his lineage back to Oedipus himself. He might, in certain circumstances, make a legitimate claim to the throne. This became a greater threat, from the old king's perspective, when Thaddeus wed a young woman, Dorling, also from an agnate family. They had a boy child their first year together, a full 2 years before Alira would give birth to Alava. So there was strong Thaddeus, an officer in the Mara, with a young wife and child, with a fine lineage and the adoration of the populace and support of the governors, who saw the chancellor as a shrewd advocate for their causes. In short, Thaddeus had become a threat that Gridulan could not ignore, even if Leodan was oblivious to it.
Guess what he did about it, Meander urged. Have you any idea?
Riolus did not, although it took him some moments to convince Meander of this.
I'll have to tell you, then,
the mean went on.
Gridulan conspired with one of his companions. At the king's bidding, this companion acquired a rare poison, the kind used by league men. Deadly stuff. He personally saw to it that Dorling consumed a dose of it in her tea. Her child, still nursing, was poisoned through his mother's milk. Both died.
They were killed at the king's order?
Riolus asked.
Just so.
At the time, nobody knew what to make of the deaths. Some suspected murder, but no fingers were pointed, not in the right direction, at least. Gridulan was the first to offer Thaddeus condolences. Leodan was beside himself with grief. Thaddeus himself bore his suffering admirably, but he was never the same man afterward. Gridulan had chosen well. He managed to snuff out Thaddeus's ambition while leaving the man alive to aid his son. Leodan did not find out about the murders until some years later, after his father died and he read his private logs. But what was he to do with the knowledge that his own father had killed his best friend's wife and child, all in order to protect him?
Perhaps a strong man would have confessed everything to his friend,
Meander said, shrugging, for he did not seem certain of this point.
Perhaps. In any event, Leodan kept his mouth shut. He told nobody, only meting out punishment against his father's companion, the one who had administered the poison. Have you any idea who this person was?
Meander did not wait for Riolus to answer this time.
That's right, he said. Your beloved father, Rethys, set the poison into play. That is why you are here before me now, a miserable governor of a miserable province. You are being punished, as was your father before you, for loyalty to Gridulan. Family secrets run deep, Realis. I can tell by the perplexity on your face that I have both delivered surprises to you and answered old questions at the same time.
It took Realis a moment to gather his wits enough to ask,
How do you know all this?
Meander looked to one side and spit out an olive pit.
My brother has a great many friends in positions to know such things. The League, for example, watches all of this with interest, glad to offer bits and pieces of information to help us stir the pot. Believe me, Realis, the story I just told you is true. A few months ago, my brother shared the information with Thaddeus Clegg himself. The news made quite an impression on him. Because of it, I think it fair to say he is no longer entirely on Leodan's side. Think of the life Thaddeus has led since Dorling and his son died. Think of the love he showered on Leodan's children instead. Think of how he supported the king when he faced the death, by natural causes, of course, of his own wife. Think how it would feel to discover that all of it was based on a lie, on murder, on betrayal. In his place, would you not want to see the occurrence punished? Revenge is the easiest of emotions to understand and to manipulate. Don't you agree?
Realis did, although he desperately wanted time and solitude to digest all that Meander had just revealed.
In any event, Meander said, returning to the issue that had started the digression, I will not kill you for your blunders, but I am afraid you will have to pay for them. I have promised Cath Gergen to the Numrek. When they arrive, you will hand the fortress over to them. I trust you will not anger their chieftain, Calroc. From what I have seen of him, he is not of a forgiving nature.
You do not mean...
Meander looked affronted.
Are you protesting? You would not have me give them to Halion, would you?
There is no other way. The fortress is theirs to rest and regroup in. If you like, you can let the army put up a defense, and then afterward you may escape to whatever fate awaits you.
Do not look at me like that. Neptos, I have never known a man to so resemble a rat in so many different ways. For a moment, actual anger flared in Meander's voice, but he harnessed it and spoke coolly.
You may now go on breathing, but true rewards come to those who serve us more effectively.
You have doomed me,
Realis said.
I have not doomed you. If you are doomed, the seeds of it were planted before ever I knew you. That is how it is with us all. That is all I have for you.
Realis managed to speak only after Meander turned to leave.
You forget that I am the governor of this fortress?
Meander fixed a bemused stare on him. Realis changed tack, moving away from the suggestion of threat inherent in that declaration.
Perhaps I can yet prove myself?
Are you as treacherous as your father?
How would you prove yourself?
If what I have to offer pleases you, I must have your guarantee that I'll be rewarded. I can give you the royal family. The heads, I mean.
I already have agents prepared to pounce on the king. They might have killed him already. Word of it may already be on the way to Harnish.
No, I know that, Realis said.
He almost felt like smiling, knowing that in all likelihood he had thrown himself just the lifeline he needed.
I do not mean the king. The line of Akaran does not begin and end with Leodan.
Chapter 8. Corinne Akaran understood that there was much she did not know about the world, many names and family lineages and historical events that refused to stick in her memory. No matter. Very little of it had any bearing on her everyday life. What she believed was of significance was that she was King Leodan's eldest daughter, the beautiful one at that. She did not stand to inherit control of her father's realm, that went to Alava, but this suited her as well. She found nothing enticing about the prospect of juggling such a complicated array of concerns. Better to stand just to the side and wield her influence within the sphere of courtly intrigue. She was sure that this would prove more interesting. The world might have been a large thing, in fact, but the part of it she occupied was smaller, and in that smaller world, few people were better placed than she to look toward the future with sublime optimism. She did, however, harbor a secret that none of those close to her would have guessed at. Though by nature a jovial person with an affinity for fine clothes, gossip, and youthful romantic musings, she bore an awareness of death with her. It was a cloud that hung in the back of her mind, always near, there to threaten when she raised her eyes to take in larger things. Her mother had died when she was 10. Since then, the curse of mortality had never been far from her mind. Alira Akaran had faded from life as the spring gave way to summer. She was eaten from the inside by an illness that began as a backache and became an insatiable leech, sucking the life from her. Corinne remembered the last moment she spent with her mother in excruciating detail. In dreams, she often sat beside her bed again, her palms clasped around the worn skin and bones of the woman's hands. Her body was so ravaged it seemed to have half melted into a mattress. Because the weather had been warm, she had often lain uncovered, her bare legs stretching out from beneath her frock, her feet and toes seeming unnaturally large now that they were the first thing Corinne saw on entering the room. Her weeks being bed-bound made Alira so feeble that she could not reach her window stool without her daughter's help. Her feet no longer knew how to find the floor. Corinne would stand, supporting her mother's frail weight as with each step her heel drew circles in the air, as might a child who was taking her first steps. All of this, converging on the young girl, struck her with the realization that the world held more frightening things in reality than it did in her darkest imaginings. Where in this picture was the all-powerful mother who always knew her daughter's mind before she spoke it, who laughed at Corinne's fears of dragons, giant snakes, and monsters? Where was the hero who chased such creatures away just by entering the room, just by smiling, just by calling her name? Where was the beauty at whose elbow Corinne had sat as she was groomed for official functions, the woman against whom all others had been measured? It still amazed her that things had changed so rapidly, without even a veiled suggestion that there was meaning to it all. As painful as this was, it was compounded by the fact that she saw herself in each portion of her mother's dying body. Her mother had given her the shape of her face, the character of her lips, the pattern of lines across her forehead. They had the same hands, the same rate of taper and length, the same character to the knuckles, the same thin fingernails, the same off-kilter slant to the small finger. The girl of 10 had held between her palms an aged, decaying, fading grip on herself, like some strange conflation of the past with the present, or the present with the future. Though she often schemed the days away with youthful optimism, part of her was nagged by the fear that she would not live out the year. Or if she did, It would be only so that she would first gain everything, then lose it all, then die. She had felt this way when she was 10, and then 11, and 12, and so on, but still the feeling was as strong as ever. The fact that she balanced these morbid thoughts with an otherwise effervescent nature was as confusing to her as it would have been to those who viewed her from the outside. She hid her darker musings as best she could, both alarmed by and ashamed of them. She often reminded herself that every living being faced death. Few of them were offered a life of such rich potential as she. And perhaps she was wrong. Maybe she would live a long and joyful existence. Maybe she would even find a way to live forever, ageless, and untouched by illness. On the morning that she was to greet a delegation from the nation of Ashenia, Corinne stared for a long time into the mirror of her dressing table, gazing at her reflection. She reached down and plucked up a horsehair brush used for applying face makeup. She dipped it in a powder made of crushed seashells and flicked the bristles over her cheeks. She hoped the sparkles would complement the glint of silvery fibers in her dress, a sleek, sky-blue gown that hugged her figure. Despite her morbid thoughts, she was pleased with the prospects for the next few days. She did not, like Alava, have to sit through the inane formalities of the official meetings. But unlike Mina and Dariel, she was old enough to function in some official capacity. This time, she was to serve as host and guide to the Ashenian prince, Igeldan. Despite her maid's warning that the day would be chilly, she wore only a thin shift beneath her dress. She could put up with cold, she said. She could not stomach looking frumpy. As her single concession to the weather, she decided to wear a new item just sent to her from Candovia, a white fur band worn around the neck and fastened snug with clasps. She thought the scarf achieved a sort of elegance. She hoped so, for she was not as adept at dressing for chilly weather as she was at dealing with the three seasons of warmth Acacia offered. Corinne met the Oshenian prince on the steps of Tinhardin's hall. She stood surrounded by several attendants, a translator, and a few aides from the chancellor's office. All of them were framed by the granite pillars of the hall's façade, rough-hewn and veined with age and weather wear. Of an earlier architectural vintage than most of the city, the hall had been built back when the nation's leaders seemed to look askance at the smooth lines and arches of cultured cities like those of the Talayan coast, which later generations took inspiration from. The prince was dressed simply. Corinne might have found this disappointing, but his actions demonstrated such practiced reverence that she had to acknowledge his manners were impeccable. He walked with downturned eyes, his arms pressed tight to his sides and his palms tilted toward her. Both he and his party timed the placement of their feet as they climbed so that they moved as of one mind. Once the young man reached the step below her, he paused. His gaze lifted up, met hers, and held it just slightly longer than appropriate. She found herself inclined to forgive him, both because of the timorous, creased smile that he wore, and because she knew that her gown and the white fur ring around her neck and the intricate braidwork of her hair and the sparkling seashell powder that highlighted her cheeks had all combined to impressive effect. Igeldan's features were famously Oshenian, his hair like straw dipped in auburn dye, his eyes intensely blue, as if they were flecked glass beads lit from behind. Corinne had once thought pale, freckled skin to be lacking compared to the creamy brown of Acacians or the near black of Talayans, but looking at Igeldan, she felt drawn to just
this feature. She wanted to reach out and touch him just under the eye and to move her finger from one dot to the next. She led the group on a tour of the main buildings of the upper tier of the city, past the various wings of the palace, down as far as the training grounds and around governmental buildings. The Oshenians grew excited at the sight of the golden monkeys that roamed the grounds and even inside the palace. They had nothing like them in their country, they explained. Corinne nodded, unimpressed. She had seen the creatures every day of her life. They were small, the size of cats, really, with puffy coats of hair that ranged from yellow to almost crimson. They had some sacred significance, but Corinne did not remember what and did not mention it. Eventually they came to the old ruin that housed the foundation stones from one of Edifus's first defensive towers. The crumbled remains of this structure were enclosed in a modern building, a sort of pavilion that perched on arching legs and afforded views out in three of the compass's directions. At its center stood a statue of Elenet in his youth. One of the Chancellor's aides stepped up to recite the first sorcerer's tale, which in many ways was the giver's tale as well. "In the beginning," the aide intoned, "a god figure known as the giver created the world as a physical manifestation of joy. He gave form to all the creatures of the earth, including humans, though he did not set humans apart from other creatures. He walked the earth singing, creating with the power of words. His language was the thread, the needle, the pattern from which the world was woven. Into this bliss, however, came mischief. A human orphan of 7 years, Elenet, once saw the god passing through his village. He approached the giver and offered himself as a servant so that he might stay near the god's grace. The giver, taken with him, obliged. But Elenet was not like the other animals that trailed behind the giver. Elenet could not help but listen to the god's song. He learned the words. He came to understand them and recognize their power. He reveled in the possibility of wielding them himself. Once he had learned enough, he ran away. He became the first god talker, the aide said. He taught his knowledge to a few chosen others. When the giver learned of Elenet's deception, he was disappointed. He turned his back to the world and went silent. He was never seen to walk the earth again. He did not sing any more. Because of this, we have the world as it is now. Judging by the way Igeldan fell to one knee and ran his hands over the fissures in the ancient stone, muttering to himself, the tale was well known to him already, and quite affecting. Corinne was inclined to frown at his earnestness, but throughout the next hour or so he proved a pleasant enough companion. He spoke near perfect Acacian, as did most of the party. Before long the interpreter and the Chancellor's aides fell back into the rear of the group, which broke up into smaller pods like children out on some educational outing.
"I wonder," Igeldan said, "if it is true that Edifus was one of Elenet's disciples. He was a sorcerer, I have heard said. That was why he and Tinhardin after him triumphed so completely. What do you think, Princess?"
"I have not thought much about it, but I do not see any reason to believe in magic. If my people had such a gift, then why do we not have it still?"
"So you don't?" Igeldan asked, smiling. "You cannot, for example, cast a spell on me and force me to do your bidding?"
"I hardly need magic to achieve that," Corinne quipped, the words out of her so casually that she had uttered them before she even knew she thought them. Heat rose across her chest and up her neck.
"Maybe we created tales of magic afterward, as a way to explain the things Edifus accomplished. Greatness is hard for lesser persons to believe in."
"Maybe so."
The prince thrummed the weathered stone with his fingers.
stood on his toes a moment, and took in the scene below them to the east.
"I guess I am a lesser man, then, because I love the old stories as they are. Your lore, in fact, plays a large part in our own legends. In Oshenia, we have no doubt that men and women once practiced magic, and that your people used it to master the world. There is a wonderful poem about how humans gained this knowledge. I will not recite it now for fear of embarrassing myself, but perhaps later I will get a chance to sing for you."
"And what of magic now?" Corinne asked. "I see no wizards around here."
The Oshenian prince smiled, but said no more. As they left Edifus's ruins and followed the back path on its slow ascent toward the king's rest, Corinne admitted,
"I do not know that much about your people. What are you Oshenians like?"
"You would find Oshenia cold. Not as cold as the mean. Up there they scarcely see the sun in winter, and it can snow any day of the year, even in the height of summer, not so in Oshenia. True, we have a short summer, but it is vibrant. All the creatures and plants make use of the few months they have. In the spring, the buds of flowers and new growth push right up from under the snow, as if one day the giver grants them leave, and then nothing can stand in their way. In the summer, the weather is quite warm. We swim in the lakes in the north, some even swim in the sea. At Killintic, we have a swimming and foot race on the solstice day each summer. The racers swim from the castle pier to a point across the harbor, then they run back again. It takes an entire day."
The two paused for a moment at the foot of the last staircase. The others had fallen some distance behind. Corinne said,
"Funny that one minute you say it's cold, and the next you talk of budding flowers and swimming. Which is the truth, Prince?"
"In a place as far north as Oshenia, it is not the cold that has the most effect on you. It is the moments when the cold recedes."
Corinne answered this with a nod, and the two stood for a moment in silence.
"But we are like your nation in many ways. My people admire learning, just like yours. Some of our best pupils even train in Alicia. But you know this, I am sure. Oshenia was the first northern country to ally with Edifus against the Mean. Unfortunately, the alliance did not live on after that conflict was resolved. That is why my father so wishes that your father would honor us with his presence. My father is not well, you see. He cannot travel, but he has spent his entire life working toward coming to an alliance with your people. He believes that we would be stronger together."
The others had not yet reached them, but Igeldan took a step up, and Corinne matched him. They ascended together, preserving their solitude a bit longer.
"And we are poets," the prince said.
"Poets?"
"That is how we keep our history, in epic poems sung by our bards. In our courts, cases must be argued in verse. It is an odd formality, but it draws crowds to the more complicated cases."
"How strange," Corinne said, although it did not actually seem that strange. She had no patience for official procedures at all. Maybe if all the government bureaucrats were made to speak in rhyme, she would be able to sit through them.
"You are the eldest of your family?" Corinne asked.
Igeldan nodded. "I am. There are three after me, and two from my father's second wife."
Corinne attempted to raise an eyebrow, although all that really happened was that both of them ridged into erratic lines.
"Second wife?"
"Well, yes, my father reenacted the old codes, taking two wives to ensure the production of an heir. He need not have bothered, but he was just being thorough."
"I see. Are you likewise inclined to be thorough?"
"No. I will marry only once."
They had reached the high balcony on the back of the king's rest. Corinne perched her fingertips on the stone balustrade and lifted her chin, pointing it out across the sweep of clear, greenish-blue sea before them.
So you say. You must have abundant beauties in your country, enough so that a man can wed more than one. You are mistaken. Think of it just the other way around. Women have half the virtues they do in Acacia. Believe me. The prince touched Corinne on the back of her hand. Princess, the day you are kind enough to set foot in Oshenia, you will be hailed as the most beautiful woman in the country, and I will be chief among your admirers. The prince could not have conjured up a more effective statement to win Corinne's pleasure. With that single sentence, he complimented her, alluded to his enduring fidelity, and promised her universal admiration. She stood dumb for a few moments, her fingers tingling, imagining the possibility that she could spend her life a swan surrounded by ducks. She answered the prince coyly and carried on with the tour, but she decided to find out all she could about Oshenia. Perhaps she had just found her future husband. Everyone knew that Acacia and Oshenia longed to be allied together. Her marriage could be a political coup. She could be princess of one nation, queen of another. This was something to look forward to.
Chapter 9. Leka Elaine had not harbored delusions about his importance to the course of the empire's history. Never in his 48 years, of which more than half had been spent in military service, had he imagined himself to have a destiny of particular note. He was just a soldier, one of many in a line that had marched in anonymity out of the haze of history. So he had believed, until one particular occasion on which he opened his eyes and rose up out of an empty slumber. A simple act, done thousands of times throughout his life, but this time it was like being born anew. One moment there was nothing, the next his eyes fluttered creation into existence, a world previously unimagined, one that demanded things of him that he had never been warned were even possibilities. At first, this creation was simply a square of bright white above him, an irregular geometry, brilliance in an otherwise formless blackness. He struggled to sit upright and find purchase on the limbs he vaguely understood as hands, arms, legs, feet. He was stuck fast. He stared for some time without understanding, with no point of focus, no context. Only when a shape cut through the space, one quick flash that was there and gone in the same instant, did he stir again. He watched the square of light long enough to catch the motion once more. A bird. It was a bird, a stretch of wing viewed from the shadowed underneath. And beyond it, creation slid, a contoured softness that he recognized as a high-clouded Arctic sky. This last revelation was the greatest help yet. With it came understanding of the pressure all around him. He opened his nose and sucked in the foul cacophony of scent and knew what it meant. He knew where he was and how he had gotten there. That first horned creature, the rider atop it, the many others that followed him out of the storm. It truly happened, he thought. I lost them all. I led them to... What had he lost them to? Who were those screaming, stomping, mirthful agents of carnage? He had never looked such malformed horror in the face before. Like the first rider, all of them had stepped into existence hungry for violence. Some among them carried spears that they hurled as they strode forward, heavy things against which Acacian armor was but a thin skin. The soldier standing beside him took one of these in the chest and flew away behind the force of it, hand one moment on the general's shoulder, the next gone.
Others of the enemy rode in on mounts that were like... what was the word for them? Those animals from Tele, rhinoceroses. They were some sort of domesticated rhinoceros, except hidden beneath a mass of matted, grayish hair. They ran his soldiers over, sometimes pausing long enough in one spot to stomp a body into pulp. The greatest shock had come when the sword and axe-wielding mass of them hit the still-huddled Acacians. They were enormous, long-limbed and powerful. Lika saw in their motions a joy at killing that he had never imagined possible. It was almost childish, the way they killed. As when one boy with a toy sword pretends to slice off his companion's arms and legs and head and then thrusts his fist in the air, grinning at the damage he imagines himself to have accomplished, so did these beings go about their real work, hacking off limbs with glee, spinning themselves into grandiose strokes that nonetheless found their targets, clapping each other on the backs. Behind their matted mass of long black hair, they were pale-hued, like the snow. Lika wanted to look one in the eye from up close, but he never got the chance. He tried to remember what orders he had given. As much as he tried to match the totality of the slaughter with some reasoned response, he could neither recall any such response nor imagine what he could possibly have said in the few moments the slaughter took. There was simply nothing to it, other than the enemy pouncing on them and his soldiers dying. Blood spray all around, limbs kicked across the sodden snow, bodies like cloth dolls, strewn about in broken-backed postures impossible for the living. It never appeared for a moment that any of the enemy worried for their own lives. Nothing touched them. Nothing frightened them in the slightest, and the damage they inflicted upon Lika's soldiers was nothing to them but a grand amusement. Lika had seen an enemy spearman pin an Acacian soldier beneath his foot. The foul thing studied the woman with primitive curiosity, and then jabbed the pronged point of his weapon straight down into her face. This had galled Lika like nothing ever had before. He roared, he directed his fury up from his abdomen, and hurled a scream across the tundra. The spearman heard him, yanked free the weapon, and moved on him. If the being loosed his spear and missed, Lika promised as he ran toward him, he would find himself gutted on Acacian steel the moment after. The spearman, though, threw with accuracy. The missile sped toward him in an elongated blur. Lika would have died if not for the actions of one of his soldiers, a man whose name he did not know beforehand and did not learn after. The soldier stepped between the spearman and the general. He caught the lance full in his chest. It pierced through him and emerged from the other side in a burst of blood and jagged shards of rib. The spear point shifted just enough to the side that it passed through the hollow between Lika's side and his arm. The soldier's body smashed against his. The force of that impact flung them both backward. The man's helmet cracked Lika on the forehead and knocked him unconscious. The two must have fallen together in a jumble, one looking just as dead as the other. That, he assumed, was why he was not more carefully dispatched, and why he opened his eyes many hours later to find himself layered well down inside a mound of bodies. Before he had been felled, he had noticed that some of the enemy grabbed slain soldiers by the ankles and slung them into piles, clearing the ground as if careful that corpses not clutter their playground. So he understood that he had been tossed into one of these mounds. Others were then piled on and around him, immobile, stuck fast within a mound of the deceased, the blood-smeared men and women of his army intertwined under and over him. He drifted into and out of consciousness. In waking moments, he came to understand existence as one of suffering and great heat. He was so packed in that for some time he thought the heat was a product of this alone. Later, he was engulfed within an incredible furnace, beyond anything the stiffening bodies could have been responsible for. He felt the corpses around him flex and shiver with it, belching the awful scent of flesh aflame. It was not until he had sweltered through this state for hours on hours, drifting into and out of fitful, nightmare-laden sleep, that he awoke to the startled realization that heat raged inside him as well as without. A fever pulsed with life from the center of his forehead. A bug was embedded there, he was sure of it. An insect dipped its curved beak into his skull, pumping him full of some venom, the round, bulbous bottom of it heaving with the effort. He struggled to reach it, but he could not move. He sweated from every pore of his body. Salt tinge stung his eyes. He licked the corners of his mouth, frightened by the crusted leather that was his lips. His teeth had changed also. They were canine incisors that cut into his tongue, filling his mouth with mercury that, try as he might, he could not expel. He gagged on it, lost consciousness, awoke gasping, remembered the heat and the insect within his skull, and realized that the flesh had begun to slough off his frame, rotten meat. And then he would pass out. Dream, wake, writhe, and on... This was all before the time he awoke to coolness and to the square of light above him and to the bird cutting shadows across the sky. He had no idea how many days had passed when he struggled up from the ghastly stitchwork of corpses under which he had lain. The bodies that had provided him lingering warmth were frozen stiff now. The mound was dusted with ice, but it was easy enough to see the charred remains underneath, the ashes kicked away by the wind. The bodies had been set aflame. Around him were many similar heaps. The mound in which Leica had been buried had burned less completely than the others. Perhaps in this chance lay the reason he still breathed. All manner of debris cluttered the tundra, blood-fouled, shattered equipment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.